First of all, roll call, it is 6:24. All are present except Mr. Destasso, who told us he would be absent because he's teaching tonight.
Do you have an extra one of these? Agenda's up there.
You're right.
I'll grab it.
No, it's okay, I don't need it.
You know what?
Keep this one.
Larry, you can have mine, there's only one thing.
I don't need one.
All right, item 2.0, it's recommended the board approve the agenda as presented.
Move, second.
So that's Larry and Mr. Porter. Call the question?
Aye.
Aye, that's a 4-0-1. Pledge of allegiance, I'll lead it. All right. Before we jump in, I just want to say two quick things. I apologize on behalf of the board to staff, the press, all of our teachers. Two or three, we all commute, many of us commute. And, 6 is just not going to work anymore. The San Diego Freeway does not turn at 6 o'clock. So in my case, I've been driving since 3:30. And in fact, last week, I think, Ken and I waved at each other. We were driving right next to each other on the San Diego Freeway.
It was a first. It was touching.
The second quick thing I'd like to do is thank Ms. David. I know we've thanked her once or twice for stepping up, and we even, you know, gave her a little something with a little temporary contract mod. But I go up and down Crown Valley all the time because I live just down the street, and I don't know how many nights, including last night, your car is in the parking lot really late. And so she's, you know.
Good thing we're in a safe area, so you're welcome.
The point is you're going above and beyond the call of duty to help us through this period. If we have a staff member who's been with us for years who's out, and these are the kind of things they can't wait. So thank you for those efforts. With that, let's go on to 4.1, budget study session. It's recommended the board enter discussion as it relates to the budget study session. I'm going to open this.
6:27.
Mr. King and Ms. David.
Yeah, a couple opening comments to before we bring Ms. David on. First of all, I 100% echo your thoughts. On a day-to-day operating basis, I'll just add to it to say that I ask questions to where you would think you'd have to have a history and knowledge base of more than 3 to 4 weeks to give me an answer off the top. And Ms. David's able to do that because she's made a real study of it in the past 3 to 4 weeks. Words don't say it. More than appreciated. We need it. We need it to be able to do this study. We need to be able to function. So very, very much appreciated and want to acknowledge you for that. In terms of what you're about to hear with the actual budget study, I want to preface it with a couple comments. It's taken me personally a couple weeks to wrap my head around some of the thoughts and numbers and pieces that Ms. David's been sharing. And so I want to give you a similar time frame and courtesy so that tonight maybe is a beginning to discussion rather so much than an end. Because I would anticipate you may want to take some of the items home tonight, look them over on your own, come back with other questions. If that's not the case, that's fine. But I wanted to prepare you ahead of time to know that this isn't the kind of budget study where you're going to be able to say, okay, so we can set aside $150,000 for speakers to come in and do CNI professional development, and we'll set aside another $50,000 for substitutes to come in so we can pull teachers out, five more PD days to the calendar year. It's really going to be about, and I'm saying this based on your comments to me, your thoughts that the two big pieces right now that we're focusing on are facilities, our Acton School project and phase 3 of Vasquez High School. So having said that, I want to just be upfront that the monies aren't there to make everything on the wish list to come to fruition. So the board's probably going to have to look at it tonight and again, maybe beyond tonight, and give us some direction as to where you see this going. Which buckets do you want to leave money in? Which buckets do you want to take away from? And which buckets in terms of ending fund balances, you know, year one, year two, year three? We have different scenarios that Ms. Davis painted for you in a very nice way, in a very palatable way, that you'll weigh in on some of those options and those pieces. And of course, the charter school part of the equation is there very well laid out also. So that's my preface, that's my thoughts on it, and I just wanted to kind of prepare you ahead of time so nobody's going into it thinking there's tons of money for everything you ever wanted and more. So, and on the other hand, it's a good problem having coming from a district, two districts, prior districts where they were both in financial crisis and having to make severe and drastic cuts to personnel and deciding where and when to make those cuts. So it's not a bad problem to have.
Okay.
You are on.
Okay. So I just want to thank you for the opportunity that you've given me to dabble in this side of the experience of education. I think, as I've come to you before, talking about LCAP, under LCFF, more and more instruction and budget are coming together as far as, an actual fiscal overall. They're practically inseparable anymore, so it's really been a pleasure working with everyone to continue our mission and what we can do. So in thinking about how I wanted to frame this from what I had heard all of you say you wanted to know, I see the vision tonight as our purposes are twofold. One, to be able to provide you with information so that you can make decisions going forward and give us direction. And so I want to clarify that all the numbers that are in here, it's as in your home budget, you can pull a number at a certain point, and if someone goes and buys something at the store with their debit card, the number's a little different. These numbers were pulled as of October 31st, which happens to be the close of first interim in the financial calendar of a school district. So that actually, it worked out okay. I know that we were in sort of a budget freeze, but I have to let you know that we did process operational costs. We've been holding on almost everything, partly because no one was there to push the button and sign the check, but also because we've been holding off to the extent possible. So I did process some of the things that needed to be processed so that we could actually have something to gauge our projections and what our expenditures on the first quarter of the year were. Second of all, to be able to let you know how we see that we're going to address the letter that we got from LACO after unaudited actuals. So, again, I wasn't sure who would be here. I know you are all very familiar with our five-year plan. So, again, just really quickly, we wanted to, our goals as a district are to have our programmatic enhancements, continue on Act in School, be able to have deferred maintenance and maintain our schools in a nice condition. Increase the general fund reserve level, LA County joint use agreement, I know we talked about that, and that may come into play as we move forward with some of these things, then expanding our relationships with other school districts and charters. So, a little background again, because I wasn't sure who would be here. And, so it's a little bit of an opportunity to help people understand, because I know sometimes there's suspicion about what are school districts doing with money. And it's a good way to think about what we have here. In school districts, there's the general fund. And in this case, in the presentation, I've combined unrestricted and restricted. But unrestricted funds in the general fund are things that can be used for absolutely anything that the district chooses. Operational, instruction, any of those sorts of things. Restricted monies come in and have to be targeted towards the students that generated those dollars. The graphic is to show you that that's our biggest pot of money. It used to be out of lots of little pots of money in the general fund. Now we have one big under LCFF, federal, state revenues, local revenues, and a little tiny pot of money for for things like special ed and transportation, but that's embedded in that whole general fund. Then, if you shift over, there's other funds in the district, and those are pretty much all restricted funds. They're established to carry out specific goals related to the funding. So for example, it would be the cafeteria fund, and we'll see that again later in some of our actual numbers. The maintenance fund, project funds, for example, we have the bond funds. So those funds, while you can transfer money from general fund into the other funds to use, you can say if we have some extra money in the general fund, we can transfer it to carry out those projects. Funds in the restricted side and the other funds cannot go into general fund. They can go there for a little while if you think you're going to be able to use it. For example, if you transfer money and say, we think we want to put some money towards maintenance and we're going to do some painting and stuff. But then it turns out later that you have to take it back and put it back to general fund because you had some extra expenditures. So as we talk tonight, that'll be something important for us to remember.
Ms. David?
Yeah.
Real quick, you probably remember this about 5 years ago, or maybe a little longer, maybe a little shorter. The state stopped providing us with funds for transportation, and we chose to continue our service and pay for it ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Are we now getting any funds from the state for transportation? I'm only saying that because I heard you earlier.
Correct. We are getting funds for transportation. That is one of the restricted funds that comes under general fund. It's a very small amount. It was capped at the level of, off the top of my head, I want to say 12, 13. There are two things that I've got to think what the other one is, but transportation is one of them where it got embedded into LCFF, but the funding level will never exceed the 12, 13.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so again, a little bit of background to help us understand the big picture when we make our decisions. I know you guys have seen this graph before, and I think it was the LCAP presentation, but the funding that comes into a district because of LCFF varies by the district and the charter. And so this same model is how charter schools are funded as well, which affects us because then when we get our oversight fees. So things to remember in a summary of LCFF is that the funds are generated, they're our main source of revenue anymore in a school district. There's a base, and that's ADA driven. ADA is your enrollment time, your attendance rate. So attendance does matter. Even a percent could significantly increase or decrease the funds that come into a district. And that's especially important when we talk about charters in a little bit, because some of them are targeted towards different kinds of kids. And then we get additional funding at grade spans, so K-3, and you get additional funding if you have class size reduction is what we used to call it, at a negotiated class size in the bargaining agreement, or at 24-1. And then we also get a grade span augmentation for grades 9 through 12 that's really to support college career kinds of programs. In this district, well, all districts, anyone who has even one unduplicated students are English learners, foster youth, or children who are eligible for free or reduced lunch. 20% of the base rate. So our base rate is right around 8,000 an average by grade span. So each student who meets that criteria generates an extra 20%. If you're a district that hits the 55% enrollment for students who are unduplicated, you get an extra 50%. So there are districts on either side of us who get the base of around 8,000 plus the 20% of around 1,600 plus another 4,000 compared to us who get 8,000 in some cases. So you can see where that difference is. And so that comes into when we're talking about, especially in our charters and revenues. So just something to keep in mind. Something I do want to give a kudo to Paulette Beekner, our food services person. She's worked really hard in helping to identify students who are eligible for free and reduced lunch. Our prior number was around 41%, I think. We're up to about 52, 53%. Now, it's not like we all of a sudden had a whole crew of kids move in. She's worked hard to identify families that are eligible and work with the families to fill their application out, and that helps us financially. So budget assumptions that were used at budget adoption, and then we verified them now. Our enrollment's around 1072, so that we need to use for our staffing and for our facilities as far as in ordering materials. Our ADA is 1034, a little bit above that. So again, that number times our attendance rate. So that's important to us for a couple reasons. One, that's what that's how we're funded. It's based on ADA. The other reason is for us, we're so close to 1,000, and 1,000, you guys probably all know this, but at 1,000 students, if you have only 1,000 students, you're required to have a 4% reserve instead of 3. Our unduplicated pupil count has risen to 574 from 504, so an increase from 46% to 53. So thanks to everyone, all the teachers and sites who helped to make sure, it generates money, but mostly it gets, food in kids' tummies. So our STRS employer rate and PERS employer rate, as you can see, and that's something that is critical, is that it's increasing about 2% per year now through 2021. So that's something that we have to take into consideration.
Can I ask you a quick question now?
Yeah.
I understood everything at this point. Obviously, I know that we pay a certain percent, thank you,
mm-hmm.
To cover benefits. We do our work as well. So when you say 14.43%, that's that means we give to STRS 14.43 for every dollar, $100, that we give, that we spend on salaries?
Mm-hmm. Correct. And a year ago, a teacher's salary was multiplied by 12.58%.
Right.
This year, the teacher's salary is by that, and it'll go up at almost 2% each year until 2021. Same thing is happening with PERS rates.
Can I ask one on that one? Because now you're going to see the limitations of my knowledge as it comes to STRS and PERS.
Mm-hmm.
Is the same employee tax for STRS and PERS, or they're either one or
That's a
the
great
other?
Question, so thank you for clarifying. STRS is State Teachers Retirement System, so that would be any basically certificated people. PERS is for our classified employees.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. And that'll actually continue about 2% all the way till 2022. So that's something that's a pressure that we have on the budget, and that's not something we choose. That's, staff will, benefit from that when they retire, but right now it's a cost to the district. Something that was not in the adopted budget because it had not been approved by the state, it was actually supposed to be paid a year from now, was the 170 per ADA, which is one-time funding for this year. So that's been incorporated for first interim, which, by the way, these are projections of first interim that you'll see in December. So that is incorporated for first interim. We've added that. We had just last meeting a restructuring of the DO staff to do some cost savings. We decreased the charter oversight and administrative fees from 3.5 last year to this year, so you won't see a change from adopted budget to first interim. But I know that there was a question about what did that do, and you'll see in a later chart about the effect of that. Because we had the decrease, but we also had some increases. We've done some, got money for projects, mostly in the other funds, and then increase and maintain the general fund reserve, I know is one of the goals, and so we've worked hard to find a good balance between that. So, general fund summary. The first thing we want to address, it's almost like we have to address this in pieces. We did have that letter that basically, the piece I pulled out of is where they said when the county reviewed the unaudited actuals for 16-17, the ending fund balance was $1.29 million. When they incorporated that into the 17-18 budget, that resulted in an ending fund balance of only $169,000, so which is insufficient. So the solution to that is I couldn't figure out how to make this any clearer other than, because I know you guys have seen the SACS form. So what you have to do is you have to look at kind of the yellow where the ending fund balance in the very first column where it says estimated actuals 2.3, and then that would carry up to the next year of the beginning fund balance, and looking at that third column, 17-18 adopted budget. That's what they first saw in May. In September, They took unaudited actuals. Unaudited actuals, what that is when every single, when the books have been closed, every single bill has been paid, we've counted up who still owes us money at the end of the year. We still had the same beginning fund balance. We adjusted for different expenditures and revenues. And so then we had, there was some transfers in and out. So if you look down in the bottom and where it says 16-17 unaudited actuals, there was a transfer out of the general fund into fund 17 and a transfer out of the general fund to fund 40 of $900,000. So those, that's money that had been hoped to be available for other sorts of projects. When they changed, when they took that new ending fund balance, 1.2, and carried it up, there's where our problem was. The simple fix, it's not, you know, it creates a different scenario, but LACO is very comfortable with this and they're used to it. We're going to transfer back that yellow $350,000 into, from fund 17 to general fund. And that fixes the problem. We're back at a comfortable reserve. Make sense?
Are you guys all on board with the chart?
No, I'm not completely there.
Maybe I can take a stab? Because I worked hard with Lynn on this when I got that letter. The beginning fund balance is, I'll call it that pinkish canary line at the top.
Yeah.
Okay, and so in 16-17 actuals, estimated actuals, it was 2.25 million. All those are expenses and revenues. And you get yourself down to the bottom green line, that's your ending balance of 2.38 million.
Okay.
Okay, that's what happens. You take the beginning of the bank account, you put in the money, and then you take out the money, your ending balance is at the bottom. That's right. And now that rolls over, just like your bank account does, to the 17-18 adopted budget, which is this next column in. Mm-hmm. And you can see that 2.348 million show up as the total beginning fund balance for the next year. Just like your bank account each month. Again, you do the puts and you do the takes on that on that column that says 17-18 budget, and you end up with an ending balance. I'm back on the green line, but now I'm at the second data column in from the left, and you get 1.23 million, and everything is good. So there's plenty of money in the bank. What we did, we did it, is we said, okay, that's a lot of money at the end of the year. Let's put some away in some of these funds because we know we have projects to fund. And so we transfer them into some of these special funds. As Ms. David was saying, you can transfer money in, you can take it back out. It's not, as long as it's not special money that started in them of those special flavors. And so that's what you see when you look at this, 16, I believe the 16-17 unaudited actuals. It starts at, that now I'm in the very middle data column. It starts at 2.25 million at the top line. You do your puts and takes, and now it ends at 1.286 million. And what changed in the puts and takes? The last two rows there, $350,000 transfer, $900,000 transfer. So we squirreled away, which is prudent.
But what's the purpose of doing that, and how is that reportable to LACO?
It's actually, if you were to look in the SACS reports, there's a report for each fund. And so you would see that there. If you actually take Fund 17, which is a special reserve, that's a fund that you can put money in for, it's typically like if you want to put money aside for textbooks, or you want to put money aside for certain.
Well, roofs are expected to go bad in 8 years or something.
Yeah. Each fund has a certain, and the thing that drives what those funds are, we don't define them, it's defined. Every district in California is driven by a certain manual that says what fund. It's like you could go in any district. If you can read the code for this, you can go to any district in California and read it. So what it is, it's kind of like at your home. If you say, you know what, for me, my daughter Kelsey was going to go to school and be a nurse. So I put some money each month over there to help pay for her to be a nurse. You're like, okay, that's great. Then your car dies. And you're like, oh, darn it. I got to take, $10,000 out to repair the car. So it's similar to that in that you're thinking that things are going to go good. You have a certain plan. We're planning for a certain thing. Or you might have another one. I'm planning for a vacation. We're going to put money aside in the vacation fund. You know, we're going to put money into the holiday fund. And then something happens and you have to pull it back for your your daily expenses. So it's similar to that. It's very, very common, and it's actually a wise thing to do because there, as we'll see in a little bit, Fund 40 is our project fund. So we had hoped to put that $900,000 and not have to touch it.
Right. So just so if you follow that, Ed, or that $1.28 million, mm-hmm. that's great for this year. But now when you roll that up into the 17-18 budget, you're starting from a lesser place, and then you get to the bottom of the 17-18 budget, and you get to $168,000. And now, these were our artifacts. The first two columns were budget.
The SACS report, yeah.
And then the next column was when we did unaudited
actuals.
Yeah,
the first two columns, estimated actuals and adopted budget or adopted budget. And again, there's state
right,
forms.
Right, but we put in one set of forms. Laco said, great. We put in the other set of forms. Unintended consequence. Didn't realize when we squirreled all that money away that, gee, if you do the math and it rolls over, you're not going to have a sufficient reserve. So Laco wrote, that's the letter we got. Now, when you called Laco, because I pieced this through myself going through all these presentations, the Mr. Hoyte said, yeah, I know that's what you did, and that's why they're comfortable with the fix.
Yeah, and I will tell you, in a conversation with him, he said that it's actually really common for districts to do that. Adopted budget, we have to come up with a budget. By law, we have to, and we make our best estimates as far as we say, I don't know how many teachers we hired this year. I'm going to say maybe 5. And so when you build a budget, you say, okay, we lost 5 teachers. We're going to rehire 5 teachers. They're about this cost. They could be less or they could be more. So what's going to come up in December is what's really considered by most people to be the true budget, because by then you've kind of trued up everything. You know what your real costs are. You're beginning to see a trend in your, so county office is really not concerned.
So we'll fix this the next time we see.
Absolutely. So the solution to their question, and they're totally happy with this.
Is the right-hand column.
Literally when he called me, yes. Literally at that moment he said, you know what, you guys have money in the other funds, you can transfer it back, we're not worried.
Now, all that being said, we know how we did it. Money didn't disappear. We didn't spend more than we thought. We didn't earn less than we thought. We tried to squirrel it away. We didn't realize the unintended consequence. We got to put it back. So that's all fine. That's a happy story. We know how to fix it. But what it does mean, and I think you just said it, Ed, is there's going to be less money in those special funds, and those special funds are what we need to do to finish our schools. And so that's where she's probably going to go next.
Yes. Yeah, it's like, okay, so literally, problem solved, we need to let our brains go on this, and then we need to move on to, we're in a new phase of the budget. Like, this is like all done.
Right, but people saw that letter, and it took me a while, and I never wrote that.
Yeah, so, like, literally, that letter's not a big deal. If we couldn't fix it, it would be a big deal. So, general fund revenue summary, and again, please remember that our first interim is projected based on any, if you tell me to make any changes here, if we find any last minute changes.
And Lynn, we've gotten that letter when we couldn't fix it, about 7 years ago.
Yeah,
that's
I know.
When the charter started.
So, and I'll tell you, so that's something we want, so keep that historical memory, because that, we need to use our best judgment as we decide how to move forward, because,
That's what we did about at that time, and it saved us.
Exactly. And the county office is well aware, so they're comfortable because they saw the money in the other funds. So, general fund revenue, again, I used adopted budget, because you saw even in the other one, that it didn't change our adopted budget. So, always we're going to be comparing to that. So our assumptions
and adopted
of revenue,
budget was July.
Yeah, right
June,
before June.
June
yeah,
June,
yeah.
June. Okay.
And so LCFF gap funding, remember, we're almost all the way there for gap funding to fully funded gap. So, and the reason that that's important is when we had a gap, say if you think of $10, when we had a gap of $5, if you were funded at 50% of $5, that's $250 new money. We're 97% of the way there.
Okay, so I've never actually understood that. So now you're doing such a good job with the rest of us, I'm going to get it.
So I don't need to overwhelm you, but these are pieces.
I gave up after the last right. couple of years, but tonight I'm going to get it. So,
okay.
So I know when you guys talk about not being fully funded, that's, what we're talking about is the fact that the state's supposed to provide X, but they give you some fraction of X. And I know that they have been increasing that fraction over time as the state's budget has improved, with some hope of someday getting to full funding. Now, we still have to do everything we have to on our percent of less than full. But, so when you say, because I see 43.97-97, what's the, are we receiving 90% of?
Okay, sorry, so, I know, honestly, I would get an F for PowerPoint on this because there's too much information on the slide.
Your charts are good.
Gap funding every year, what happens is the way it's been calculated during phase in of LCFF is every year there's the target amount, which is how much they anticipate you'll get when we're fully funded per student, and there's the current amount. Whatever the gap is between that. So you say if you get $10 a student at the target, and right now you're $5.
You have a gap of 5.
You have a gap of 5. Well, okay. They talk, and that's new money to you. You always get that plus the gap funding.
Is it normal to have a gap that big?
Well, it's what the state's doing.
Okay.
It was at one point, yeah.
You just said something important.
That's it is very important.
What did you mean when you said that is new money or something like that?
Okay, so every year, it's very, very important when we're talking about the gap funding, and as we think forward, it's critical for us all to understand this, to make decisions. The gap is, okay, every year the gap funding is new money to the districts. It's addition over the prior year. So say
okay,
you had 1,000 students.
Yeah.
1,000 students, and that didn't change for the entire time of phase one. And your target is always 10. So when you had a gap of 5 and they say, yay, we're gonna get 50%.
Right. And the next year 50%
of 5 is significantly more than 50% of $1. So several years ago in the beginning, schools were seeing lots of new money. New money meaning money more than the last year.
Yes, so let's say in the beginning of LCFF, they were at 50% of where they wanted to be, and where they want to be is 100, and when they go in 2000, the next year, and they say, well, this year we're gonna do better than 50%. We're gonna close the gap. We're gonna give you 60% of the target. Certainly that 10% is new money. So does that tell me that right now we're at 97% of target? Okay. And relative to last year where we were at something less than 97% of target because the gap is closing, what was last year's?
Last year we were about 96% and they funded about at 50%, but so
that's where I get lost.
Okay, so here's the thing, we're not getting a lot more or less new money than we did this year. There's not much gap to close.
Right. So each year, as you asymptotically get
towards
full funding, the incremental increases are less and less.
Yeah.
Yes. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, that's the big picture. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, we were flush with money because there was the gap funding was significant.
Well, I'll say it differently. We were less poor. Then, I mean, flush is a bad word because it's money you really should have been getting. So just, so we were less poor.
The big idea of that first dot is that for the next little bit of time,
it ain't going to change much. The additional money is not going to change
much. It's
going to
be small.
Because we're on that asset.
The running graphic that every financial presenter has used since 2007 has been referred to as the alligator chart. Alligator mouth, and so now we're here. Just about close.
I got it.
But to get us back to 07 funding, back in 07,
that's the target.
2011, 12.
Thank
you. The mouth was like this.
Right.
Now the mouth is.
Right. Now.
That's my elementary
impression. Eventually, yeah. So the target is 07 funding. They don't increase the target for inflation?
No, of course not.
Okay.
Not really.
All right, thanks. Keep going.
There is an answer, but it's really complex. So the big picture of that is the new money, because they will never, they won't give you, if you always had a thousand, you won't get less than the prior year, and you'll get a little bit more. Federal revenues, Title I, we don't get a lot of it, but, you know, any little bit is a punch in the stomach. A little bit of a decrease on Title I and any federal revenue. One-time funding was added, so that's a plus. It was not supposed to be received by districts for an entire year. It was promised, but you wouldn't get it for a year. And the governor, in the enacted budget, said, well, okay, no, we'll give it to them. So that was 170 per ADA that is an increase in the budget. Charter oversight and admin fees were reduced from 3.5 to 3% for this year in accordance with the law. And there's, actually, we'll look at that just a minute. And then there was increased revenue from charters due to projected increase at ADA. And so...
Let me catch up on that. Increased revenue from charters. So we are, these are all differential statements. So you're comparing today to when? When we adopted the budget or last year?
So a few different, okay, so the first part is just the different revenues we get. We get LCFF money, we get federal. So that is compared adopted budget to first interim.
Okay.
Down below in charter revenue, because there had been a question, and
yep,
I want to point
that's
out
a statement.
That that's not separate money.
I understand.
That's embedded in other local.
And then the last one, increased revenue. Are you trying to tell us that since adopted budget to now, there is more ADA at the charters?
Yes.
Okay.
So what
so something's gone our way in that last bullet.
Thank you, Ty, for being my pointer.
Since we adopted the budget. Something's gone our way. Okay.
Yes. If you look at it, and it's a little bit different direction than because the other goes across, but P1 is what it was based on in 16-17 during a certain reported period, so period one of reporting. ADA was 89-22, and that was 16-17.
Okay. I see it.
Then the ADA at adopted budget was 91-07. And then working with Amanda, and she was great calling all the charters and saying, how many bodies are in your chairs right now, or do you expect to be by around December?
That last two lines is great news.
Yes.
I mean, if you're trying to finish a school so you can, and you've already given us the heads up that it's not good enough news, but if your goal is
it's
to finish a school to get kids in it and get your classes smaller, that's good news.
Right.
Now, can I ask a question of Amanda?
Sure.
And you guys jump in if
no, I'm gonna I want to hear the presentation.
Okay.
And
I apologize. I'm gonna
get deep into this stuff.
Okay.
And I have a question after you.
All right. So, from 9100, which is our estimated enrollment at adopted budget to the 12,000, is that growth because across the spectrum our charters have grown students, or is it the is it the Youth for Learn?
Options for Youth.
Options for Youth.
It's both.
It's both.
So Options for Youth is about 400 and something ADA, but we've also had growth in Assurance Learning Academy, and Spire and IB has grown this year. So
only 400 of them are Options for Youth?
So far.
Okay. Now my next question is, of that 9,100, that included, I think, some of the schools that are Shasta schools. And this is the last year, this is the one and only year of waivers.
So we have three schools that are on waivers. Method K-8, which only has about 20 ADA.
Okay.
Method 9-12, which has about 100 ADA. And then the big one is ILEAD, which will probably,
how many kids are there?
There is, Method has ILEAD has 2342, somewhere around there. We're probably going to lose 1,000 ADA after this year. That's the only one I see losing.
1,000 off of 12,200?
Correct.
So we'll still be significantly better than when we adopted the budget.
And I think we'll have more growth.
Okay. All right. It's important. It's a source of revenue, and I was afraid it would be worse than that. But in fact, if you go back to when we adopted the budget, even with these losses because of Shasta, we think we'll still be ahead of when we adopted the budget next year. Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Keep going, I'm sorry.
That's okay, and so to clarify one other thing, and Amanda did say, but I just want to restate, as far as one of the other things that that helped in first interim is in adopted budget, because it's really foolhardy to include something that's not a certain thing when you're talking about that it can make or break you financially in the district. There were two schools, and Options for Youth, I think, had not been finalized that when adopted budget happened. And there was another one that had a conversion, I think, and they didn't have a new CDE number, so we couldn't count it. So that also accounted for the change in there. So we did get confirmation of that, and then we worked that into the budget. So even though we did lose a half a percent, because it increased ABA in revenue, we actually have more revenue. So the other reason, another thing I want to point out on there is the reason I included that slide about how the factors that affect the amount of LCFF, because we get 3% of their LCFF, some of our schools really target, not in a bad way, but you know, really market.
They're trying to serve.
They try to serve and market students who would they would be a very high percentage. So some of those schools are getting, you know, $12,000 per ADA. And then we have other schools who have, let's say, a more affluent background, and they're probably getting 8,000 ADA. So
3% is not the same for everyone. It depends on upon what they.
You got it.
How does I had a couple of quick questions. How does a school get 12,000 as opposed to 8 based on the affluency of the?
It's law.
Is that?
It's the law. It's the calculation.
So how is that calculated? How is that?
It's the actual LCFF formula.
The income of their parents?
No. Ms. David told us earlier. If a student is either foster or free and reduced lunch, or what's the third category, Ms. David?
Foster, low income, or English learner.
Or English learner.
And they're only counted once, is that? Right. You can be all three of those things?
So if a poor kid is all three, he doesn't count three times.
Yeah.
But the state's reasoning, you can see that the state, Mark's been going off about this for years.
Yeah, free lunch stuff.
You know, the state's reasoning is, and, you know, I get it, doesn't mean I like it, is that it takes more money to educate kids with these kind of problems. I mean, and there's facts and data behind all that. There's a correlation.
I don't think this
more money. But you're right. You're absolutely right.
This is a we conversation.
You're absolutely right.
This is not a we conversation. This is a you and you conversation.
That's fine.
This is not a we conversation.
So at any rate, that's why they do it, Ed. And Ms. David's given you kind of the numbers. And when you reach certain thresholds, then there's extra collection costs. And I think the relevance of this is it's hard to predict where the income's going to be, because it's hard to predict the student populations in quantity and in makeup.
Right. So, like, the big picture of it is we're pretty certain. And other things like that unduplicated, so supplemental and concentration, that's a three-year rolling average. Because, like, for example, we went up significantly, but it's going to take some time to really see the dollars from that, because it's 3 years average, always moving. But the reason it's important for us is, like, for example, if we go and try to attract more charters, it's hard to determine who will approach us, or, you know, it could be one that has many $8,000 students or many $14,000 students.
Okay, so I just want to understand as you go along, so, you know, I don't want to go past anything without completely understanding it. So
no, that's why I'm here.
As far as, if you go back to the one before.
This one?
No, go ahead. Where's the one that
the chart you were just briefing?
Yeah, there you go. As you see, we're like in 60,000 less on the federal fund from 822 to 763. What is that based on? How does the, I know it's not that much of our budget, but what is that, maybe about 7% of our budget?
That's a great question. So, I actually really appreciate that you guys are being reflective and digging into this, because that will allow you to make the most informed decisions that affect all of us. So for federal, what that is, it's based on, that's actually based on ADA.
Okay.
But it, Federal money is typically ADA. It serves, it can serve various programs, Title I, immigrant students, so we have a few different, a little bit of special ed. But there's actually a reduction at the federal level in funding overall. There have been cuts to federal programs.
Based on how many students we had less, or based on how much less they're paying?
No, based on the per ADA. The federal government is not as desirous of supporting our students and thinking that the state should just do it all.
Totally got it. And then this question is for Amanda. As far as the, you know, I know all the history on our 3% going down from 3.5% because that's what's legal to do. Does that mean that previously we weren't in compliance with the law, or is that a new law that now we're in compliance with?
The 1% oversight is the law.
Okay.
So the 2% admin fee, I think what's done because that's kind of industry norm, not law. I don't think we were out of compliance, as you saw with our state report that just came in. We're within the law. The 1% is the law, and that's what they're really monitoring.
So can you make, I heard that. I just don't understand part of that. I've heard, is this incorrectly referred to the 3.5% being illegal, 3% is the law? What does that mean?
I have not heard that. 3.5% is legal. I have heard that.
The reason we changed it was because we were out of bed with
them. I know.
And you don't want to attract attention, nor do you want other people to take your collaboration.
It's law.
Okay, so if you go back and get on television, you'll find that when our ex-superintendent sat in front of the Assembly Education Committee, there was questions as to why you're charging 3.5% when the law is 3%. Now, in addition to that, to just frame this properly, when you have people that are negotiating with your budget that have outcomes related to your budget, and that's the way I'll put that, and that'll be that. If they're going to be able to put more money back into their school rather than give you that extra percent, half percent, you can't blame them for doing that. But let's just do it this way and say that we're at 3%, and if the market is to become more competitive, there may be a time when you look at individual schools or do whatever and charge whatever percent you feel is appropriate. But if somebody comes along and says to you, I'm going to offer you what they're doing for you for 3%, for 2.5%, that can change the market and introduce some volatility. Again, I don't want to get too far down the path. I got some very things I'm going to ask about specifically volatility, and based on the data we've seen, what that looks like in the future, the best you can tell me.
I'll take out my crystal ball.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, so, and one other thing, because I think I feel that you guys are really trying to like wrap your heads around this. I'm not going to lie that I went, whoa, $585,000 difference in other states. So since I last sat in a business seat, there is a law called GASB 68. And basically what that is the STIRS that we talked about, the retirement, has to be shown as a contribution from the state to a district, and then it has to be shown from the district as an expenditure. So on the next slide, you'll also see a pretty significant increase in benefits. Because I thought, ooh, great.
It hits the revenue side, then it hits the expense side.
And it nets to zero.
It nets out.
So, truly, it's not really that different if you were to take that piece out of it. You know, I needed our guy that we, you know, use as a consultant to explain that to me, because I actually did not realize that. I got pretty excited, and he said, yeah, no, it nets to zero. So, okay, moving on to expenditures. So again, I wanted us to look at that, on the right-hand side, debits and credits, but so some of the assumptions that we used in expenditures, there was an increased cost for step and column movement, and that's incorporated for this year and then also in our out years. So just regular step and column movement, nothing about raises or anything like that, step and column, yeah.
But I get that. Wouldn't we have known that when we adopted the budget?
Yeah. Yeah, so some of this is already incorporated and adopted.
Well, and I guess that, all right. It's the precision with which you estimate it
and we're only talking about $32,000 or $35,000.
Yes.
I mean, part of me says you should know how your step and column is going to be a priori, because you know who's stepping and who's columning. But you know, when you say, well, that's $8 million between certificated salaries and classified salaries, and you estimate your step and column increases and only miss by 60, that's not bad. Now I understand. I shouldn't ask the question.
Yeah. So I will try and do. That was already incorporated in the adopted budget, but it trued up a little when we know how much a new teacher actually is going to cost us now. Cost of STIRS and PERS rate increases, that was incorporated already in the adopted budget, but of course we need to keep that in our minds that that's an increased expenditure compared to other years. We did have, and this is a new piece, reduced cost for reorganization of the DO staff. Health and welfare was budgeted, that's the H&W health and welfare budgeted currently contracted district contribution rates. Professional development was included there. That's not new, but it was something. These are things that are in there that I tried to put, you know, because there's only so many dots you can put on a slide. But those are some of our bigger ticket items that we decided as a district were a priority. So we had our professional development for the 3 days for teachers, and then incorporated within there, and it was an adopted budget, is the services that were in LCAP. Things like the English language arts adoption, the additional counselor, the safety, facility maintenance, and things like that. So those are in the budget. They were in the budget, it's just now we have a better idea of what the true costs are.
So the 452 for benefits, that's probably the pass-through that you were talking about?
Mm-hmm.
And then, the capital outlay, the 243, I'm sure that's the architects, the contracts that we allowed for the architects to get our plans together for DSA. Capital outlay must be acting school. The services, that's 150 larger than what we budgeted, but within the LCFF or LCAP or LCAP. What is it precisely?
Services are...
We did the... Is that Chromebooks? Was it part of that?
That would be more operations. Services, okay. Part of it would be LCAP goals and actions. Part of it is just like the cost of doing business in a district. Things that would fall under services in a district required accounting format is it would be legal services, it would be if we have a contract for transportation, consulting services, certain things like that.
Okay. I mean, at the time that we adopted the budget, mm-hmm. you know, we used more legal, we've had some issues in close that have kept us busy. So we also had services like the search firm that found us, Larry? Okay. So these
right.
Are the
other things,
that
it includes is, for example, because remember, this is our unrestricted and restricted combined together. So it also includes, for example, services for our special needs students who have, we had contracted services. We have, for example, some students who need a behavior specialist. And so those services would fall under that column.
And they might command a little hotter and heavier than you thought at the budget.
Yeah, if we get new students on,
right.
You know, who have different needs or the needs increase of a particular individual.
And transportation as well, right?
If we have to contract for transportation, yeah. So those are our expenditures. So the good news, I think this is good news. This is our multi-year projection. This is the format that Steve gave us. I gave you hard copies where I played around with a little bit, but if we change nothing, other than making the first interim projections, so first interim will probably be pretty easy for whoever's doing it, because it's not gonna look, a lot of it's done. The good news is that in this current year, we did have to, you know, move the funds out. We see the transfer from to another fund, the 350, actually from the other fund to the general fund. It restores our balance, and our ending fund balance, our ending reserve will be 1.4, and we'll have a reserve of 8.74. carrying that out and carrying all of our step and column, if we're making, using the assumptions, carrying them forward each year, not adding or subtracting, you know, no enhancements, no reductions, just carrying status quo forward on making adjustments for things that are required, like STIRS increases or step and column. The second year we have 7.82. The third year in 1920 we'll have 5.51. So it goes down a little, and then it begins to go back up in years 4 and 5.
What
and I did ask him to take it out 5.
What happens out in 4 or 5 if the trend actually reverses? Does that heuristically make sense? Does the revenue side go up? Certainly the STIRS and HRS increases may not go that far out. The 2% more and more and more and more, they may stop that. But it's interesting that it rounds the bend on its own without us doing something.
It can be. I would have to dig into it further again, but I believe it's because, for example, certain things, like some people may cap out on a scale, and so they're not getting those jumps and step and column. And I would have to totally dig into it. Personnel, certain programs, the other, you know what the other thing is? I can tell you right now off the top of my head. Because it's probably a multiple things in years 1, 2, and 3, because currently this year, our ELA adoption, Cassandra was great and was able to get that in 2 years, spread in 2 years. So, but that's a big ticket item, and that's embedded in there. It's not shown as any program enhancements.
But we don't have a big ticket item like that, let's say.
In years 4 or 5, yet. No.
That doesn't mean there won't need to be some,
right?
Because I can tell you what's embedded in there, and it was in the LCAP, is in current year and the second year. So 17, 18, 19 is the ELA purchase, and then some books for the high school, for AP and things like that.
You're
the third year is $300,000 for an adoption, probably MGSS or.
So we do at least something. Have an adoption out there for year 3.
Yes.
It's just year 4 or 5 that we're maybe a little rosy because right now we're not booking any adoptions, and I can't say whether or not we'll need one out there.
Right.
Yeah.
I said next generation.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The other thing that's embedded in there, just because it's big picture keeping going forward, I mean, I worked with Ty to try and find out as far as replacement of our Chromebooks, because they are a part of our instructional life now. You know, kids need them in the classroom. You can't even take the state test without a Chromebook or some sort of a device. So each year embedded in there is $100,000 approximately for a 5-year replacement cycle. And that's even stretching it a little bit. So there are some things in there, but especially those textbooks aren't in years 4 and 5.
Now, and you guys jump in when you have a question. So you said that everything stays the same. So that means our ADA of about 1,000, you're assuming, stays the same. We don't have big swings in personnel other than the STIRS and PERS contributions. The charter ADAs, are they assumed to hold flat from here? Okay, but we just said there's 1,000 that could be disappeared.
In one particular charter, but there could be growth in other
right.
charters.
Right, so we need, unless we're going to structurally do something differently, we need to collaborate at other places where some of our collaborations are falling apart, because the collaborations help us do things. Okay, and if we don't want to shrink that way, we need to maybe collaborate a little bit more. So
I'll get into that.
It is what it is. Okay.
I'll get into that in depth.
Okay, very good. Okay, thank you. So the assumption is flat.
The assumption is flat, yeah, because, I mean, and again, first interim is what's considered the real budget in most
okay.
districts. Second interim really shows us
I
how
I was referring
yes.
to the out years. You're just assuming they're flat.
Okay, so remember that little graphic with the pots of money. Now we're not talking about the big pot anymore. We're done with that pot for a minute. We're talking about the little pots, two little pots, and these are funds for specific things, but not projects particularly. Fund 13 is our cafeteria fund. The quick and dirty on that is if you look to the far right bottom, $12,000 is our ending fund balance in cafeteria. We feel that's realistic, and those funds can only be used to support school nutrition. Fund 17 is our reserve, not capital projects. Now, it could be capital projects, but that's, you know, usually where you'll put it for other sorts of things, because there are other funds for that. So we had put the money there, we had to take the 350 back, and so that will leave us at $1,000 essentially.
Basically we're zeroing that account for all private purposes.
So those are not funds that we can think about for our other goals. So, focus first please on the first part of that graph, the table that has an ending, you know, remaining balance of green. So those are our other funds. Fund 14 is, there's not really a deferred maintenance fund officially anymore, but most districts kept it and they put money there for exactly what it sounds, deferred maintenance. Things that are not just regular routine, like let's, you know, fix a toilet handle or something. These are painting and big things. Right now in that fund, there's a balance of, I wish I could see well, but $687,000 approximately. Fund 21.
Okay. I'm just trying to figure the columns out. So the first interim budget expenditure. So first interim was 627.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, six. How do I read across the columns then?
Okay, so first interim budget expenditures. Really the thing that's interesting is there's not, it's just lumped in there right now in remaining fund balance. So what that means is there's a certain amount that was budgeted.
Uh-huh.
So what that means is at some point in time, somebody said, this amount of money, it's going to cost this, something's going to cost this amount of money.
Okay.
It's not distributed out to line items.
Okay.
And working with the guy who does the accounting. It's just lumped in there. At some point, someone said, you know, we're probably going to have $637, $620
right.
worth of
stuff.
Projects, stuff. You know, concrete work or painting.
Okay. And then
or
what's the next column?
The next column is the remaining fund balance. So those are things that are not attributed. That's like there's nothing budgeted there. It's in like a holding spot in the fund.
So it's not encumbered funding.
It's not even on, there's
okay.
in
the fund, but
it's there. In the fund, but no specific planned expenditure
Thank
for
you.
It.
Okay.
And that's the total. So then, actuals and encumbrances are things that we've actually got either a contract. So an actual is like the bill actually passed through, and encumbrances, we got a contract, we passed it through and said we
yep.
made a contract for that amount. So, and
so the
and those are actually
truly what's
actuals.
Mm-hmm. The green is
green.
What's truly available.
Yes, the green is what's available.
Thank you.
Left. So,
to pay everything below the green.
You got it. You got
He's
it.
Ran ahead.
Okay.
I also can tell you about how much short it is.
That's you know, green, because green is fun spending money. Okay, so then the first part of that second little box is the project. So the first part is Vasquez. Oh, and actually, if I can back up for 1 second. So looking at those funds, in the second column, Fund 21, there's very little left, $25, but that was the bond fund. So when the bond was passed, that was the money that was used so far to build everything at Vasquez that's happened so far. That money, I don't know how much it was to start with. I only know that there's $25 left. That fund 21, can only be used for anything that was listed in the bond language. Fund 35, school facility, that is the money that the state gave to the district for Vasquez.
That's the match.
The match.
Yes.
So those funds can only be used for Vasquez until the project is closed out. So say, we know that it'll probably cost more, but say Vasquez only cost $1 million, it's closed out from what we told the
and
state we
were
anything after closed out
Available.
Can be used. But until it's signed and closed off and the state says, okay, you've met your agreement with us,
if
that
I
can only be used for Vasquez.
There was 13.2 in Fund 21 and 15.3 in Fund 35.
Okay, and
there
so
was Fund 25 there? The
Fund 25 is where we put developer fees. So for anybody who comes and builds a house, there's a certain fee that's paid to the district, to the assumption that at some point in time that house will generate.
And we're going to see at some point if we can requalify those fees and see if we can charge more, right? Because periodically every 5 years we do that.
Yeah, that's on my desk. Like there's a one-year report that's due to you, I think, in December, and a 5-year report just of expenditures.
Yeah.
But we do, yeah.
If,
with all this turnover, it's a window that opens on some periodic basis, so you don't want to miss the window. We've missed it before.
Yeah, okay.
And I think this is a magic year. It's something that Mark's been admonishing us to keep track of in amongst all the the turnover.
Okay. But at 205 right now, it should probably be...
Because then you're stuck with the old rates for a couple more years.
For 5 years.
Meanwhile, everybody else around you is collecting...
Yeah, higher rate.
Higher rates.
Like in Pacific Palisades, it's $17 a square foot.
Really?
We're paying 205. We're charging 205. Of course, we can't do that. But we could probably be in the mid-threes.
Okay.
Yeah. And if we were an area that had developers... that's where those funds would be when they pay.
There's not much development right now. Anymore,
yeah. So that's a little bit. But that's a great point, because in Fund 25, that's not something probably that will generate a lot of money. We're trying to be conservative there. Fund 40 is capital outlay, so that's a fund that you can use to pay for anything related. And capital, an easy way to think of it is you turn a building over and turn it, shake it upside down. If it falls out, it's not capital outlay. Like this counter, different things like that. If it falls out, we can't use the money for it. If it's something that's improving the building's facilities, then you can use it for that. So that one, from what I was told, that has historically been the Acton fund. So going back down to the project. So working with the architect and project manager, I guess is what his role is, they've informed me that the scope, and so there's hard costs and soft costs. Hard costs are the construction and the labor, soft costs are engineering fees, things like that. So the hard and soft costs for phase three, parts A, B, C, and E of the high school, which includes the softball field, the restroom, concession building, ADA parking, and the fees related to that, is a total estimated amount of $2.7 million. There are bid alternates, and the bid is going out right now, and we'll get that, I think, December 12th it closes. So we'll have a better idea, but there are alternates on the bid. So when they go out and bid, they're going to bid on the top part, and they're going to say, well, our truck's already here. So the estimated amount is on the right. The total of everything else for tennis courts, basketball courts, tennis court lighting, and the fees for that are about another $1.2 million.
So, none of these numbers, though, are actually from bids. They're estimates from architects.
That's correct.
Okay, so we can keep our fingers crossed. I don't want to say anything. In the past, I'm not sure it spreads that big. But in the past, some of the bids have generally been a little bit less than architects' estimates because they don't want to get our hopes up.
Right. Those bids come in when about? You said the bids...
I think they're due by December 12th.
I think bid opening is December 12th.
Bid opening. That means that's when we open the bids they've provided us? Or
yes, they have to have sealed bids, and then on December 12th at a particular moment in time.
So are we going to actually let the contractors in the room to watch the bid opening this time?
They're not allowed in.
No.
We don't let them in.
No one's biting on that bobber, huh?
Because that's...
So, what the project manager has explained to me is that, you know, if money weren't an object, what sometimes will happen is they'll say, well, since we're already driving our tractors around to build a baseball field, the tennis court will drive it for cheaper than that. So those are bid alternates. We don't have to do that. But it will probably cost us right now an estimated 2.7 to do what we need to do at Vasquez. Acton has been constructed in two phases as well on the plans. So the first part on the very bottom section is phase one, and that's Acton School for $697,000 are the hard costs, and that's to clear up any fire life safety issues that are basically clearing up the ADA things. And what that would do at Acton is that would make it so that, at least what they're telling me as of the meeting this week, is that it wouldn't make it pretty, but we could legally have students here.
$700,000 to get kids in here.
Yeah.
Correct.
Plus some soft costs. So a little bit more than that, I think, let me just take a look. I think it's 871,000 hard and soft cost to get kids in the door.
How much, I'm sorry?
871,000. Because the hard cost and then times
697 plus some amount of soft.
Yeah, 697 times 0.25%.
Oh, okay.
0.25.
I see. Thanks.
So it would be a little bit more than 871,000. Now again, I want to ask them again. You know what they said is it won't be pretty, but they could come.
Now,
but it doesn't make it acceptable for ADA.
No, it does.
It does. Phase one.
It gets kids in.
Oh.
Well, does our ADA piece with the ramps and all of that sort of thing?
What it's my understanding that it won't have. No, I don't think it includes the ramps, and it doesn't include the sidewalks and such. It would basically the pathways, the paths of travel would be as they are right now.
So what does it mean upgrade for DSA? The ADA being.
That would be to resolve the issues with like the air conditioners that were not secured properly.
So shouldn't we be looking at the 914 instead of the 697?
No, because we can't even do that second part until the first part is done. They won't even pick up the plans. Yeah, they won't pick up the plans until we do
but
the first
part. I mean, if you're not certain, say we're not certain. What I'm leaving here thinking, based on the way you said it earlier, was notwithstanding Larry's good questions, you know, how can you have ADA things on both lines? Notwithstanding that, does it stand to reason that you really can open after $697,000 worth of work, even though there is some ADA stuff? That's the next line, that's included in the next line down?
I need to pin them down further on
okay.
that.
Because it doesn't pass the, I mean, they're, you know, if they said it, it's probably some rash logic, but I'm not getting it off the chart, that's for sure, so we should ask.
Right, because I'm trying to pin them down. My question to them specifically is at the end of phase one, could we get butts and seats?
Peace. And the corollary question to test that hypothesis is, okay, then how are the ADA improvements on phase two not required to get butts in the seat? I mean, right, to make dang sure that we know what that means. Okay, peace. You know.
Now, I'm just wondering if we should be looking at the $2 million when we're talking Acton School.
Probably. I mean, to get children here and have it be as desirable a learning environment as Metal Arc is right now.
And when you add up those three buckets, 2.7 and 1.2 is 3.9, that's 5.9. That's $2 million more than the green.
Exactly.
Right, and so something that, you know, we have to keep in mind is that depending how far we spend down, those funds are not funds that typically get restored. You might get, I mean, you guys probably have a better idea than I do. I'm going to say maybe we get $20,000, $30,000 of developer fees in a year, maybe 40 in a good year. Those other funds are not going to get replenished except by transferring funds from general fund. So if we have a major repair, a main line break, a roof cave in, we won't have anything to do that.
Though. If we wipe them out.
So, yeah. Now again, I've dug and dug and dug, and this is as deep as I can dig in, you know, 3-4 weeks. I've asked and asked. The bottom line of the person who does, you know, the consultant that the district uses is that, no, this is how much there is. And sans any changes in ADA, and I'm talking positive changes, changes in the state every once in a while when revenues come in very, very well at the end of the year, the state will true up and say, oh, you know what, that 43.97, we're going to bump you up to, you know, to 50%. They'll give you a little bit more, but there probably aren't any giant windfalls that we can expect. So, You want to go to the next slide?
Well, last question.
Or you want to stay here for now?
The estimates on the bottom. Architect estimates. The plans are not yet approved to go out for bid yet for Acton School. Larry?
So one more time.
I'm sorry. So we know the plans are done and we're getting at some real numbers for Vasquez come December. So, you know, we just hold our breath for a month and see if something really good make us feel better than this does. But for Acton School, the status of all the engineering and the plans with DSA is where? Because that's when we have plans and we go get bids, that's when those numbers firm up.
Right. And I don't know if you want to answer if you want to, but I think I know. Based on the conversation that we last had, so right now there are four items that are still needing to be closed out at DSA, and again, we're talking only about Acton School at this point. There are four items in the old closeout items that need to be completed. The only thing remaining on those is to have the fire system tested, and there are two. One is at the school, and the other one is at Awadulse. So I believe it's tomorrow or the next day the system will be tested here.
At Awadulse?
Here and then.
What does Awadulse have to do with Acton?
Because when the original plan was submitted for that particular plan number, there was something linked about the two schools. I think it was based on portables or something like that. It was originally put in as Awadulse and Acton School,
so
and they were linked together.
Cleaning up business that never got finished
from
before,
the 90s.
And DSA saying we won't really talk to you about new business till you finish your old business.
Right.
So
that's pending. It's supposed to be tested. Hopefully it'll go well. So a week, couple weeks, they've got the check. As soon as that's done, they can drive it down. Literally, from what I've heard, the plans are sitting in the bin, waiting for somebody
to say it's okay to look at them.
Go ahead.
Well, go ahead, look at them. Not
yes.
Go ahead, approve them. They haven't even looked at them.
No, and from what I've heard, there's like literally minor changes on them at
that
point.
What I'm trying to establish is, so we did all this engineering. And what I'm trying to get my head wrapped around is, and so you go to DSA and you say, because that's a lengthy process with them, say, here you go. And what I'm trying to figure out is, if they've looked at it and said, okay, we've looked at it and we've given you our feedback, but we won't approve it until you close this stuff out.
Correct.
That connotates a short timeline. If they say, well, thanks for giving it to me, but I'm not even going to look at it until you finish the last job you had me do with you, that connotates a longer time. So, do you have any feel just from your chit-chatting with the...
My thoughts, it's the shorter timeline.
Okay.
They're just, all they want is for us to close these items
and then
out.
They will ding.
It's done, yeah.
Okay.
We'll be able to move along.
And to get those closeouts done, only because I see the word... okay. Phase one and light safety issues. But if we're getting, hopefully, closed out like this week coming up, that means it's not that $697,000 of work. Is not. It's not like we spent the $697
to
get to the point where we can close out.
No.
Well, and part of it depends on this NFPA test. When they do that NFPA 72 test, depending on what comes back, if you need to redo a big part of that system or all of it, it could be very costly.
I understand, but I guess what I was getting at is, we keep our fingers crossed for this.
Yes.
Just like when our kids go for their midterms. But we haven't spent any of that money in the lowest table to get to the point where we can do the test. The test is something totally
correct.
Different. Okay. Once the test hopefully passes, then they approve the plans, and then those plans are currently estimated at $2 million worth of work. And we won't have real estimates until we have approved plans, because that's what you go out to bid with.
Yeah, I mean, part of the issue is like in that phase two, that has to do with the exposed ceiling because there's the tiles,
T frame or something like that.
Needs to be strapped in a certain way and supported, and that needs to be inspected. That needs to be for DSA. That's in phase two, but you don't want to bring in children into a classroom where there's exposed. well, you can see the wires, you can see the duct work, you can see all of that. So, you know, there's the thought, well, we can go ahead and make it look pretty so that students can enter the classroom, and then if the DSA inspector needs to come in, it's not a big deal to open those up, pop a couple tiles, they can inspect and look and improve. So that those are the kind of discussions we're currently having.
The other thing that I'm trying to ask them to do is, you know, when we're meeting with the, you know, the construction people and the team, is to look at, when we're looking at both phase one and phase two, and in those proposed costs, are certain things as they relate to the items that DSA was unhappy with. So I said, are there ways that we could reduce those costs by changing either the scope or the materials that we're using without destroying what we had in mind? You know, and so that is a discussion that we may be having in the near future. You know, can we trim the costs at all and accomplish what we'd like to accomplish in a less costly way? And still make it an inviting environment, a safe environment for kids. So, any questions on this before we?
No.
Okay. So, again, just the summary is we of what we've accomplished is the restructuring, elimination of admin position, revenue growth will slow down, and STIRS and PERS contributions we talked about to death. The good news is we are able to meet the 4% reserve in the current and two future years. We'll probably need to make additional adjustments to meet the five-year plan goal. I think I heard that a goal was 10% reserve at some point in time. So if we're going to do that, we need to figure out what we can do. You know, there is volatility in the state. I mean, the good news is I read an article just before we came here that there is some talk and some suspicion in a positive way that the governor may fully fund LCFF instead of going just, you know, the 50 or 70% they were talking the gap. Now remember, the gap is small, but every little bit helps. So as we get more information as the budget year progresses, and then we do need to keep in mind, as you know, spoken about, is that decreased general fund reserve percentages and depletion of the resources and other funds decreases our ability to manage cash flow within. So I think you guys have been in situations before where you get a tram to manage cash flow. So right now we're able to manage it because we have those funds, and so we don't have to go out for trams and such. So those are just some things to think of. And then the questions down, you guys each have, I think, four sheets of paper, which show some alternate scenarios on that table that you use to manipulate usually and put some funds, move some funds into or put some extra expenditures towards a priority. What I tried to do with those, just because I thought rather than manipulating as we speak, that you might prefer to be able to spread them out and see what the effect on the reserve would be. The first one is just status quo, just a copy of status quo. The second one would be if we took $161,000 out of general fund and put it towards, it could be anything, I put it on the Acton
line. But for example, we know from the last chart, we have $4 million for projects, assuming we want to get that dime of it, and $6 million of projects. So moving $160,000 out isn't going to make that gap a whole lot smaller.
I'm just trying to
understand.
That's
what I understand.
It's 1%. So.
You got it.
But that's the way that you ponder this.
And one other comment on these, notice it says draft. These are really a working document, and that's why just the board has them. This is a draft, a confidential document for you that maybe this is something, again, you can come back with after you look at it, sleep on it, that sort of thing.
And I think one of the other things, again, I know that, you know, Mr. Mustasso had spoken about, and we all talked about joint use projects. I'm not as familiar with them as I'd like to be, but you know, it could be that maybe that would be piece a way to fund some of the other parts of this high school, because I think I heard that they want to use tennis courts and stuff, but we may need, you know, we could possibly.
How so? Get them to pay for it, you mean?
I don't, like I said, I don't know enough about joint use.
Larry, I can tell you that we should pursue it. And we've been thinking of it in the context of something grand, like the pool. The board before you in these kinds of deliberations had been thinking of it in the context of things that were kind of grand, maybe, like a pool, right? We got tennis courts, we the district. Maybe they do a pool or help us do it. But those things take so long to materialize. I mean, look at how long it took to get Acton Park to materialize, that we should be working, I'm just going to use.
And the kickoff at Acton Park actually hampered any joint JPA agreement that you would have in the future, because there was such resistance in the community.
Exactly.
Do you want a community center? Do you want this? Do you want this? No, we already have the community center. We have this, so now we're 10 years into it, and like Mike said, it's.
Mr. President,
I was going to finish my sentence.
Okay.
Everything you say, I'm not repeating.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just suggesting that it's good to pursue that. It's not going to be our solution to finishing phase three anytime soon, because getting through a joint use agreement, them agreeing, them coming up with their part of the money, I mean, that's why I said it took a long time just to get Acton Park there. You can imagine, and that's when there was a bond of park funds. That's not going to be the silver bullet to finishing this, unless that stuff's not going to get finished for a long time.
Didn't we, when we were talking about this before, have an extra $2 million instead of being short $2 million?
Well, we did.
Just rounding it off.
Yes. So I think it's important. That's a great question. The whole reason we're talking about phase three is because we had money left over from phase ones and two. So we cannot miss the fact that any level of disappointment we may have is our leftover money isn't going to go as far as we hoped it would, but it's leftover money. That's the whole reason we're even talking about phase three. But at this point, we're all salivating over what phase three could be, because that really does finish the school. You know, so anyway, so you're right, Larry, there was money left over, and that's part of what's in those funds. In fact, that's what's left of the state matching funds.
Right.
The joint use options and things like that might turn out to be a worthwhile thing to pursue. The last time this came up, and Dr. Woodard was here, and there's things I agree with, and there's things I disagree with him. But this is one of the things I agreed with him on, and he had some grave concerns about what a joint use would mean to us, especially in terms of security, and in terms of allowing access to our facilities to, let's say, the Antelope Valley students and adults, okay? So if they want to use our gym in return for us using something of theirs, or, you know, I don't want to see us selling our soul to the county or the Antelope Valley or anything like that. Any type of joint use agreement or anything like that that's pursued, it's got to be agreed to by the board, and hell, if we're going to ask the community about the calendar and things like that, I think we should be asking the community whether they want to share their gym with the Antelope Valley. That's something that we should not on our own pursue. It should involve the community, and it should be at the direction of the board, not as a pet project of any single board member, myself, anybody else included, or outside influences by community members that may have other agendas that, you know, what we're here for, which is the stewardship of the best interest of the children and the funds of the community, which that original $13 million bond came from and took four times to pass. So joint use is something that Dr. Woodard at length banged head with some people on the board at opposing, and he kept that from happening when he was here. And he could probably write an essay on all the downsides of it. So I don't get excited when I hear joint use, and I'm baffled by the pursuit of it by some people and by the articulation of it.
It's a huge mystery to me. And like I said, it should be at the direction of the board. And if it had a 3-2, 4-1, 5-0 vote, whatever, if it passed, I would support it like I always have. Things that I voted against that passed, I've never said a word about it after the fact. So if this happens, if we go after joint use, it should be at the direction of the board.
If I might, there's nothing really that you said that is at all to be disagreed with. Any agreement we would enter into would come before the board as a vote.
Well, why is it being pursued now very strongly now?
Yeah, there's a lot of spice being thrown around the community for one reason or another. I work for an organization that
we're actively pursuing a joint use agreement right now.
We're in discussions of it. Well, it cannot hurt to have discussions.
Well, why don't I have a discussion with the YMCA to come in here on my own?
Are you suggesting we shouldn't explore ways of getting...
I think it should be done by the board. I don't think...
Okay, so
I myself,
we have a vote to have a discussion?
No, if we have a vote to go have meetings with the YMCA...
Can we control this meeting and carry on so we can...
I'm just saying,
get my questions answered.
I think we're in agreement. I think if it's something that we pursue, it should be something that we get to vote on. It doesn't just rear its head one day.
Absolutely.
And
have, anything.
You know, and the community should be involved.
Of course. Nobody disagrees with that.
I mean, it's way more important than the calendar.
There's different periods of... Yes, when there's some action to take, certainly. But this is very vague. Speak with them and see if there's any opportunity. That's it.
Well, I'm a Catholic. I'm going to start speaking to the YMCA. I'm having a meeting, and I want you to be there for 3 hours next week. Okay?
Yeah.
And there is a
we want to have the meeting.
And there is a joint use currently, and that's where we play softball currently.
That's the park. That's the park. Mike, there's a whole. I'll talk to you in person after. There's a whole effort going on about basically putting our school out there for rent, basically, and the community should be involved.
I hadn't heard.
We're gonna have a swimming pool, and I work for the system that has the most widely seen ever swim gym in the whole world. It was on. You'll see it every time you watch. It's a Wonderful Life. That's managed
by the
department I work for. So I get this, and I know what it is. Can I do my question so I can go?
Sir.
First. And Lynn, if you know something, that's great. If you don't, just tell me I don't, and whatever. And we're responsible to him, not you guys. And I hope you don't ever feel that you're being beat up by directness or anything like that. But I appreciate
it. I like directness.
Good, so do I. Let me ask you this. Do you think that we've capitalized or captured the funding that we have available to us for free and reduced lunch and the Title I stuff? I know that you mentioned Paul Ladd and everyone is working. I mean, you can't just sit people down and audit their personal finances and ask them to come forward if they're uncomfortable. But do you think we're close to at least removing some barrier, either perceived or real, that people would be afraid to come forward?
Well, there's a reason to ask them with the charters that we don't do that.
Hang on.
I believe that going this year, because one of the things we implemented with Paulette was we went to an online form. So now families, it's available in English and Spanish, and it's online and in paper. We've had people at the schools, you know, in registration. So I believe that anybody who has any desire to have their child fed will. The other thing that she's done is for those of us that do have access to highly confidential information, so there are very few of us that have access to it, in the CalPAD, which is the state data system, there is a list of students who are identified for direct services through the state because they get state aid, because they are a foster child. We have some families who don't live in a foster home but are still part of the foster system, so we have access to that and we've begun using that. So we have probably captured at least as well as we can or is possible this year every student that
without being intrusive.
Correct.
Yeah,
do you really feel that we have captured as much as possible in that regard?
The things, like I say, that we have taken on is there are a couple of addresses in the community that meet homeless criteria, namely our campgrounds. So she asked me did it seem reasonable? Because there may be families who live there because they love the great outdoors and having a couple children in a small home, but I'm going to say no. So if they live in that address, we're able to direct certify them because of the address. Families who are eligible for any kind of state services that would meet those criteria, we have ability to do that, so we've identified those students and families are online. So I believe we have.
One of the things that we should try to do is lower the stigma associated with that whole process. So something that I'm familiar with that we've done in the past is that you can cross-reference siblings. Oftentimes there's a kindergarten or first grader that are there in the program getting a free reduced lunch, but they may have an older sibling in secondary education who isn't. So sometimes you can cross-reference and do pieces like that to ensure that everybody has the opportunity to get that lunch without the stigma associated with it, because a 15-year-old is very cognizant of that and aware of that, and so there's things like that you can do as part of a campaign, so to speak, to help families.
I can certainly relate to that personally. The thing that as a trustee is important to me.
Do wrap up because he was in the middle.
All right, I'm sorry. May I?
Yeah, do what you need to do.
So yes.
Sometimes I know the answers already, but the camera doesn't. And the people out there don't, so yeah, finish up.
No posturing on my part here for a camera. What I'm really wanting to know, as a trustee, what's important to me that balancing this concern I've always had with the charter model as a source of our income to about 30%, 33% now, right, of our income is coming from the charters. And in the long term, since we do have that model, I want to make sure that we also maximize our income for any other sources. And I just don't, I personally, just me, it might be naive thinking, I don't see us, you know, in the long term being a district that's got 15, 20,000 kids that are somewhere out there in, you know, cyberspace, and you know, here we are with just 1,000 kids where we used to have 2,600 kids. It just causes me concerns. Not that I'm not very proud of what we've done with the charters and very protective of maintaining it, but at the same time, it's not very realistic for the long term. You know, and that's, I think that, I don't know if this is true or not, and probably isn't, but I've personally been accused that we don't maximize these things in order to maintain our charter thing going. And, you know, we have to look at every source of funding, in my opinion. That's where I leave it.
Okay, next. If, let's say you have a special needs child, and I can relate to this, and there's an availability to recoup funding legally, let's say Medicaid funding, are we taking the steps we can to capture that?
Yes. That I can say that we do. Yes, there's a thing called SMON. All of us who are eligible for capturing that funding get a little flash that says, what are you doing right now? We turn it in, and then Amanda and I have been working on that because each of us have a role in that, and so we have been...
I can speak personally to that program being rolled out without anybody having to feel bad. So to summarize this little line of questioning is this. I'm not a proponent of sitting up here and whining about how the state is screwing us over year after year and using that as a catapult to say, well, we have to have these charter schools in order to survive because there's some model that doesn't reward us properly. So I'm just saying, I think it's fairly evident to me, especially with the recent gains we've had in free and reduced lunch, and it's my understanding that that program can also identify other things that are needed for those kids. I don't want the kids coming to school hungry, and I don't want them embarrassed because that creates a very poor learning environment. Next, the funding source that we showed, it seems to me that the funding source is not so much the bond saying, here, do all these things at Vasquez High School, and redo act in school, but it's more so excess funds that are coming from somewhere that they're building in a balance. Would that be a very basic way of saying that? without, we can pull this chart back up and look at our fund balances.
I was gonna say, I'm not sure.
And I don't think there's $4 million left in the school bond fund.
No.
Bond fund to do this school. So my idea is, I don't think the state is funding us to build all this stuff. So my jump is then automatically to, this is coming from charter school income. Would that be a fair assumption? If it's not, what percentage would be a fair assumption?
On these funds, I would say not necessarily, and I can't answer exactly what percentage, because for example, Fund 25 is developer fees. So probably each year some, and I would have to go back and see historical. Usually probably maybe $30,000 to $40,000, I think, is what's typically budgeted.
But that's not gonna get me anywhere near $4 million I need. Okay, so.
No, so it probably was transferred at some point in time.
Okay, good, nothing wrong with that. And I wanna tell everybody that the state has the ability to decide what happens with these charters. So we haven't discussed this in here, this report that says some school districts improperly authorized and inadequately monitored out-of-district charter schools. We're one of the three contestants in here. But this is not an enforcement document. What it says is, legislature, if you don't want this to go on, then you could do these things and these things. And one of those requirements is that we're better about real-time data coming forward about where our schools are at. Because their concern is, our kids being educated? And are things being monitored properly? Is money being, you know, sent off somewhere? So, state, if you don't like it, then do this. And until then, we haven't been told that we have a cease and desist on any of the findings in here. And I think that some of this that we're seeing tonight is actually a remedy for some of the things they want to see more adequate reporting and numbers I couldn't get to. So that said, I want to talk a little bit about volatility. And I'm not going to talk about to the collective. In other words, I've just got a big pot of kids that are coming in and out or whatever. Do we see a volatility in the individual charter systems that is notable? So do we have a school that's over here that's got a lot of kids that's losing a lot of enrollment? Can we pick that out? And if so, it strikes me that there would be two reasons that would be happening. One is the market share is being lost to declines in program quality or student outcomes or some other factor, like the Einstein High School mess and all that kind of thing. Or is these fluctuations we're seeing related to a reaction to the Shasta case? Could you summarize what you think has happened over the last year or two or whatever you have data for?
Sure. I have one charter that has declining enrollment, and I think it's over program and not over the Shasta ruling.
Okay.
The majority of our charters, like I said, have stayed status quo. We might see a little bit with our couple that have the waivers with a reduction of ADA,
okay.
But there's three that have grown continuously.
Let me, and I'm not going to hold you any numbers here, but this one you're talking about, I don't want to know who they are.
Mm-hmm.
What percentage would you say that takes up of all the students you have? Is it 5%? Is it 10%?
No.
So it's less than that?
It's less than that.
So the majority, what I'm trying to say here is, because I was painted out in the press as being anti-charter. I'm not anti-charter. My voting record, now that I've been up here a year, says that. I'm just anti, don't come in here with something I don't know what it is, and I want to know about the volatility, because we clearly have a dependence here. So the volatility has been mostly over the Shasta ruling.
No, has not been over the Shasta ruling.
So what we're saying there is, it kind of stabilized itself.
It has stabilized itself.
So, from what you see right now in the near future, other than somebody coming through and jamming something through the legislature quickly, which is a joke, or some legal action, there's not likely to be a huge volatility, at least for the foreseeable future.
For every charter except for the two that we have, or the waiver charters.
So, what I'm asking you then is there some, like, magic number? Like, if I sell widgets, I'm gonna have drop-off customers. So if I come to you and say, hey, I'm gonna borrow $10,000, I'm in a little bit of a bind to get my numbers back up. You give me $10,000, but I'm that $10,000 to get paid back, there's a 40% volatility in the market every year, so I have to find 40% new customers. Are you seeing that to be the case here, or anything near that? Perfect. Now the revenue from ancillary services, meaning special ed, facility use, rentals, things like that. How much volatility have you seen in that area?
Almost none.
Is that volatility, if there is any, does it seem to be centered on certain charters? And again, I don't need to know who they are.
There's literally almost none as far as facilities.
So you haven't lost anybody? You know where I'm going with this. You know where I'm going, and I'm going to get there. Trust me.
So if they have asked that they no longer want to have space, they don't have to have space. If they have space, they have space. And the only volatility is in ADA at Albert Einstein Agua Dulce.
Okay.
Because their facility is based on their ADA.
That's what he's talking about.
Okay. So, yeah, and I'm also going to ask about special ed. You know I'm going to get to special ed. And you know that I'm going to... that we're going to have a discussion about $300,000 and $400,000 that somebody pulled out of here to go somewhere else. We know that. You know that.
What are you talking about?
Well, let's let them get to it.
Okay. So nobody.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking about. So what's the dollar amount of that?
So our loss in, so we have AB602 money or special ed money. Last year we took in a total of $673,000.
Mm-hmm.
This year, based on our projections, we'll take in $461,000. So our loss will be about $211,000.
Okay, and that is based on somebody's ability to either use our services or find them somewhere else, which is completely legal.
Correct.
So when you're dealing with private entities, that's part of doing the privatization of public education, that's what you do. It's similar to contracting for air conditioner repairs, is basically what it is. So there's not a huge volatility there. Okay.
Is there any indication of others following suit?
No, our newest charter came all on board instead of going elsewhere.
We were a little nervous after the first one went,
that
maybe others would follow.
They usually
maybe others weren't so intimate with their own system.
They usually come in with, they either have a relationship with a charter SELPA and they just want to stay doing that,
mm-hmm.
or if they're new or they want to try something different, they'll usually start with us at least. So it just depends on the charter.
I want to finish that line of reasoning off with, do you think the state will ever say, I don't think that it's a good idea for you to be charging percentile of ADA for services like special ed, when there's not really a correlation between the service I actually give you and that's traceable? And I think that's kind of what this gets at. And suddenly you have $4 million sitting over here that you didn't get from a building bond sitting there waiting to build a school. My question is, at what point, and this isn't directed at you, this is a statement, at what point do we quit beating on special ed saying it's an infringement upon the general fund, but yet the system allows this money to be charged in excess to build schools in another district, in another place? I have yet to understand that, and I probably never will. Okay, moving on. The WIOA thing. When I saw WIOA, you want me to explain that? I did it as best I could. What I'm saying is, our special ed funds that we're charging people are funding our projects. That's really clear to me. Next, WIOA.
No, that's not what we're talking about. But
so that I'm asking about
what you're saying.
Volatilities.
Yeah.
So if I said as the state, if you send a speech language therapist to Agua Dulce at Einstein, and they spend 2 hours there, and the negotiated contract amount is X, then you bill that back to the district, and it basically covers costs. The idea about being a taxpayer is, public funding is not set up to charge excess or to be funding things. Let's say you get an assessment to have your road paved, and it doesn't get paved, and then you find out, well, why didn't the road get paved? Well, because I paid the superintendent and the new guy that took over Larry's place over there, but that's cool. That's not the way it works. It results in overtaxation, it results in fees that aren't approved. that type of thing. So my question really is there any anticipated volatility where someone can say, you're going to have to charge, and I think we need to read this really close, actual costs and account for those actual costs and not build some fund up somewhere by charging a percentage of ADA that's not reflective of the actual service. Now, the other side of the coin is this. You could actually contract for amount of ADA and have special ed with, I don't want to say the wrong combination, I'm the parent of a very low incidence child, where you could have a number of kids come in to drive your costs through the roof, and this could be a losing proposition. So there's a balance here, but I'm saying it's pretty obvious to me that, well, I'll jump into oversight now. The 1% oversight, let's pretend that we have a budget of about $16 million, right? Because it was up there. And I told you, you can take 1% of that to provide district oversight. So I got $160,000, right? So I'm going to staff the district office for $160,000. Superintendent, everybody, right? I don't think so. So the idea that we're going to oversee all these charters comes with the idea, I think, that they have their own costs and there's some amount of competence in what they're doing, to where your oversight is just to come in, do a checklist, do an audit, and say you're doing good, you need to improve your income. So the 1% oversight to me does not seem to be a huge money maker. Could we agree? So the money is actually in the ancillary services. So what this little exercise was to try to develop if there's any indicators to you that say they're going to stop it through something like this. And I think the answer was, I don't see any legislative action on there. I think that I hear you guys saying that you're tracking costs a lot better, real time. And I don't see another lawsuit coming our way that's saying you're not going to supply special education services. And I think that the charter model says that you can't mandate that to force people to use your special education services if they choose to participate in another SELPA. So right now there doesn't seem to be a lot of volatility in this funding. Okay. Now the WIOA thing, I want to talk a little bit about that. When that first hit me, it seemed like every time, and I'm a veteran of the courtroom, I was in the courtroom every time there was a ruling made, either in the court in Newhall versus this district, or the appellate. I also went to every AEA a charter rejection petition, so I know a little bit more about this than the layperson. I didn't learn what I know on the internet. I heard it coming out of the judge's mouth. This WIOA thing first struck me as I couldn't call it that, so now I'm going to call it this, and I can still sponsor all my charter schools out there. But when we went through the last meeting, it struck me, my question was this. How are our scores, our proficiency tests, in comparison to everybody else regionally? And I think, you know, there's some up and down and whatever, and it depends on what students are there and what grades. You get great ones, you get a few that aren't so great. But it strikes me, for the most part, in California, there's a widespread proficiency problem at the state level, meaning that the majority of kids aren't proficient in the basic core subjects. So then I looked at it and said, between the 8th grade, and correct me if I'm wrong, and the 11th grade, there's no testing. So you've got a couple year gap where, imagine you're running a business and nobody had to report any financials for 3 years, and then suddenly you would go, why am I upside down and in the hole? So there's not, short of what we have in local controls and the things that we track through our, what do you call that system, guys, your principals?
Interim assessments.
Right, where you're looking at a kid going, I think you're computerized to do that now, and going, hey, I'm seeing a drop here that I haven't seen before, let's focus there. But it seems to me that there's this kind of general consensus that somebody's gonna drop off the map, 50% of the kids aren't going to be going to Stanford Law School. So what I'm wondering, it caused me to wonder, are these WIOA programs not actually meant to recover an educational opportunity and give people to say, okay, I've got my GED, I've got my certificate, and plus I'm working to become a viable candidate in the workplace. So my question then is, most of the stuff that we have is out there somewhere. Do you see any volatility coming along where somebody out there finally says, these kids live in our town, maybe we should take care of them? Or are they loyal to us for the service we provide them?
I'm not exactly sure what you're asking. We do have Assurance Learning Academy, which is one of the WIOA job board providers right here on this campus.
Okay, so and local so kids have, that's
local
really important.
Kids have
a local
to
kid has a way, an option. But the ones that are way out there, and that's where most of our income is at, face it, are those, do you see somebody finally out there going, hey, this is our town, this is our school district, these are our kids, we should sponsor these people? Or is there still that resistance, and are they going to stick with us because of the service we provide them?
I think they will stick with us because of the service we're providing. I think that I can speak a lot to Assurance Learning Academy because I've done a lot of work with them over the last year. They're, you know, way down San Pedro in that area. Those high schools rely on them heavily for their dropout recovery. They don't want to see them go anywhere. The districts are sometimes nervous about sponsoring charters,
okay,
but they know that they need them and they want them. And so I don't see a lot of volatility there right now.
So where this ends up is, I've asked you guys to summarize this. Are we making every reasonable attempt without impeding people or shaming people into getting free and reduced lunch? Are we doing what recovery we can through governmental agencies to recover special ed costs? And so this idea that we're not maximizing those programs is a hinge point to say, oh, we have to have charter income. I'm looking at, it's basically about 20% of your income is charter right now.
30.
I just divided what was up there. I come up with about 20%. If we took that 20% out of the budget right now, actually this works better for the math. If the 20% of the budget went out right now, where would we be? Bingo, certainly not worrying about building a school with $4 million. So I don't recognize any volatility in the questions I've asked, and I think I've covered just about every aspect of it. So it looks to me like I can look out at least a year or two and say, it looks like the funding that you're predicting will be there short of some catastrophic thing. Let me close this out by talking about JPAs.
And as much as we're worried about the funding that we get from the charters, in the same token, we should be worried about the program that those charters offer. I mean, you have to be a real thick person not to think that the focus that we have towards the charter is a financial one.
Okay, so that leads me to my question. I'm a mind reader. What are we doing to increase our local ADA? This is a rough question. Have we fallen into a rut here where this money's just coming into the tune of $4 million a year, and it's coming, and I don't really have to worry about it that much? So that's not a question that can be answered overnight, and I'm not silly. I've lived here for 13 years. I understand that if you have sports, if you have the field, if you have those kinds of things, you're going to retain some of the athletes. If you have, the extra classes.
Steam.
Extracurriculars.
Yeah, if you have that kind of stuff, if you have the electives that are geared towards what you want to see coming in, if you're building your relationships with the local colleges, because we've got now, everybody gets to go to college, to a community college for free. Please be cognizant of that, and let's not fall into a rut where we just think the money's coming in, so we have to be.
Let me respond a little bit to that.
Yeah. Here we go.
Going back to some of your earlier, which I think are very poignant questions on volatility and reasonable, nobody has a crystal ball. Nobody can forecast the future and say this is 100% guaranteed. But I've had some of the same conversations that you're alluding to with Ms. Fisher. Based on those conversations, I'm confident in sharing with the board that I think And also having come from a district that's also small, small rural mountain community, the same challenges with budget and finances, very similar, that I commend the board for the position and the actions that you took. And I researched the history of what you've been through quite a bit. And I commend you for doing that in the face of a very challenging time. And then getting through that whole process in a very litigious time as well. So all that to say, I think it was a viable and what turned out to be a legal, compliant avenue to get you in a position that you now find yourself, ourself. And I do think it's a viable path for the future. But it, you know, to put a percent on it and say, got a 90% or an 80% chance of success looking in the out years, I think would be tough to do, but I think it has an excellent chance. I really do. And I think even in terms of the report, the pieces in the report that they were alluding to in terms of the timeliness of your oversight responsibilities, we're doing an excellent job with that thanks to Ms. Fisher. And so I'm very confident in our district's ability to continue to do the things that they're expecting school districts to do in terms of that report. And then the latter piece of it, I'm trying to remember, we were just talking about, what was the last piece we were talking about?
Building our own ADA.
Yeah, you know, I talked about this even when I met with the board during the course of the interview process, but there's intrinsic motivation on the part of our educators at our school sites, but now I can say it after being here a couple months, but before I was saying it in kind of generalities in terms of an interview process, but now I can say in retrospect that our administrators, our teachers, our classified employees, they have an intrinsic motivation to make Acton Agua Dulce School District the very best it can be. And they come to work every day with their heart and soul into it. So I say that after 4 to 5 visits at every school site, walking our classrooms, talking with our teachers, meeting with our employees, our culinary students served us and cleaned up the meals after our celebration today at the Women's Acton Women's Club at the Community Center. So there's a lot to be proud of and to raise our flag high. So I'm very confident in our schools.
I appreciate so much the way you support your staff openly in public. I appreciate your ability to hand off to subject matter experts in this with full confidence. And again, I think I've run through just about everything someone could ask you about where the volatility is, and I just don't see it. So I think that where I'm at, I want to touch on this joint powers agreement thing for a minute. The JPAs can turn into a mess if you don't write your specifications. Let's say you're going to open up to AYSO. AYSO is the greatest thing in the world because they allow every child to play, and they encourage every child to play. But when your field use it is exceeded to the point where it's concrete with grass on it, and you're sitting back going, hey, I need recovery time, I need renovation time and things. You gotta make sure that in these agreements there are things to where it doesn't turn into a lost leader and then suddenly your constituent becomes the sports group itself. Like I said, the swim gym, that's a great idea, but we all saw how long it took to get a gym built. We saw how long it took you guys to fight in the community, and I don't think you really got it until you walked in the place and went, wow, this is awesome, this is cool. And I can appreciate Mr. Porter's concerns about when it gets to a point of it becomes, let's schedule this thing as much as possible, the county is going to give you funds to use your thing. It's like the city I work for typically gives the school district $12 million a year so we can use playgrounds and stuff. How would you like that? You know, so, but again, it's a long drawn out process. some of the community was resistant in the beginning. People are resistant to things that are brand new to them. But I think I would agree with Mr. Porter that the community needs to be involved. There needs to be some really good understanding of what the maintenance processes are, that our investment is protected, that people that are gonna wear down the thing are actually contributing to the maintenance of whatever it is, and that we have the full community support so we don't have people coming in and just taking over our facilities and running them into the ground. I believe I'm actually be quiet at this point. I'll close by saying this. I did vote to hire Mr. King or his staff to run his staff. I'm really interested in hearing the way these programs are. Can we go back to what the project list is? Yeah, there. I would be really interested in seeing staff come forward and say, in terms of what I have for educational capacity, in terms of what I have for creating the best educational environment, in terms of what works for a teacher and the kids in the room, in terms of what this is gonna do for our athletic program, I'm really, per se, not interested in sitting up here and telling you that I like baseball. I'm interested in hearing what you guys as professionals, how you would prioritize this, because I think I've established through my long, drawn out, tedious process, which I hope you've all stopped smoking, listen to me, but I tend to hypnotize people, but I don't see volatility. So that aside, I'm personally hoping that staff will come forward and prioritize these things for us, and that would is what I would look to support.
So that's a great segue, Mr. President. That's a different thought than we came here prepared. Our thought was more let you see the same information we've been dissecting for several weeks, and we've been looking at. Let you look at it through your lens and provide direction for us. If that direction includes, hey, staff, go back and take a look and prioritize for us your thoughts, we can do that. It wasn't what we came prepared with tonight.
Of course. In fact, I think you took the words right out of my mouth there.
I didn't expect that, really.
Me neither. But it appears that there's a gap, and the difference, hopefully, is, you know, maybe it's premature by a month or two to do that prioritizing or assessment, because some hard numbers, at least as it relates to Vasquez, will be in a month. But then when those hard numbers come in, you know, there's got to be some racking and stacking, because it became clear to me from Ms. David's exercise on the four pages that, you know, squirreling away $160,000 out of the operating budget or something isn't going to close a $2 million gap on wish list.
It's something.
I understand. So, you know, closing that gap has to happen, if it's going to happen out of the other budget, the operating budget, let's call it. One of two things has to happen over there: more revenue or less expenditures. And maybe there's a little bit of wiggle room there, but that takes time to pay off as well. So my vision of this is we should be looking at revenue and we should be looking at expenses on the other side, if nothing more than to ensure that those reserves do come in the way you expect. Maybe grow a little to help with this. But it seems that in the spring or right after the early part of the year, we're going to have to think about what's in and what's out. And as far as you guys making a recommendation, that's rational. I mean, we'll discuss it, but I think that's rational, because there's things that you can conceptualize that we couldn't, which is, and I was going to ask you to talk to the architects about this as the prices come in, is, okay, what makes sense? How could we maybe bundle off of these cafeteria items in a logical way that gets us facilities that have the most bang for the buck or aren't repetitive with other facilities around? And then but provide a path so you don't have to tear them up in the future if you ever do get lucky enough to do the next thing. So, I mean, that, and which is the kind of the approach we took with building Vasquez in phases. And so that's what we're going to have to do with that side.
So let me ask you this. Are there any assumptions that we could walk away with this evening, specifically with regard to the Acton project? Because in the immediate future, that does help us to move forward with some things.
Can I respond to that and also ask a question first, though?
Sure.
Is Fund 35 the matching funds from the bond?
Yes.
That has to be spent on Vasquez the way, and I helped draft this.
Yes, it does.
The bond, what you call it, that we voted on. That, because
voted in deafness.
I specifically did not want that bond money spent for anything except Vasquez High School, and I assisted in that drafting, and it was approved, and that's what the community voted on.
And
so if we take the $4 million and I think we have to deduct Fund 35 and Fund 21 from the $4 million.
So million seven.
Because it has to be Vasquez. And that leaves us $1.7 million and to spend on these other projects. And my personal opinion is that I don't want there to be, I mean, I would hope there's not even any talk about it, of taking the projection project cost of Acton School and trying to any way do away with it. That's one board member's.
Any way do away with it? What do you mean?
You mean not?
I mean, it's got to be funded.
I mean, do away with having Acton School.
Oh, we're so you're at kind of the same place mine is. I mean, we're already down that path. Can't we have that?
Well, he wants guidelines on this area.
Yes, yeah, I mean, you know, we have two phases there. We have a budget there, so.
So you're saying we don't have enough money to do all of it?
Well, it depends. If we want to make that a priority, if that's an assumption, we're all going to say, yeah, make that happen. We're committed to Acton School, phase one and phase two. That's got to happen. Then that's a different discussion for us when we come back to you with some priorities in terms
what
of
does
phase
that come
three.
At the cost of? Because I don't think you have enough money to do all of that, to do that
okay.
And phase three.
You're right. So Larry's on to something. May I?
Yeah, absolutely.
So look, there's $4 million up there. $2.3 million of it is by law only Vasquez. So let's not talk about that $2.3 million. Let's not talk about Vasquez for the moment.
1.7.
That's 1.7. If you clean out the bank, which is what Ms. David was alluding to, and what if something else happens? You don't have a piggy bank for those kinds of things. But even if you cleaned out the bank, this 1.7 in Acton School looks like 2 million from what the numbers we know now. And so, although I was a little bit dismissive of tweaking the operational budget a little bit, we might have to grab a little something out of there to finish Acton School. But for the guidelines, I don't think it's appropriate at this point in time when we have 1.7 million one could claim for Acton School, and that means cleaning out the piggy bank entirely. It wouldn't be prudent to say, well, we got to commit 100% to phase one and two of Acton School.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because first you're $300,000 short, and even if you made it up, you have nothing left.
Mike.
And so that's all where I'm suggesting, I would say, well, phase one is certainly going to happen if that's what it takes to get kids in here. Phase two, we might have to phase in.
Right, and if I can just clarify, in the projected first interim, just to restate and clarify, because maybe I didn't clarify, at this point, having worked with the numbers and looked at our encumbered and actual expenditures to date as of October 30th, we already made what every adjustment within revenues and expenditures that we believe we can realistically make at this point. If we're carrying out the trend of our expenditures through the duration of the year.
I agree, for this year. I agree.
So this year, other than that little embarrassing amount that, I mean, I was just trying to give you guys something to entertain you with, you know, that, I mean, 161,000.
Well, it's not really embarrassing. I take back those words, and I don't think I put those words on there. I just said it wasn't a big amount.
That
could be a critical gap filler.
Right, I think one thing also is I will have to look into it, but some of the things like the technology infrastructure, the backbone, may or may not be included in that. So there may, I have to see what other things were not included in the project cost. I'm still unraveling.
Go ahead.
Can I throw this? I want to throw a monkey wrench in here a little bit. I think that the progress we're going to make on Acton School is going to be such a huge confidence boost to this community. I really do. Next, I think that the DSA, would everyone agree that I think we're getting better or actually are good with DSA to the point where they're our partner and they're not looking at us like, oh, you're trying to get away from this. We're actually working with you, and it's to the point where we get the job done and get kids in the school because that's what they're supposed to do in support of us. The one thing that really bugs me about your school tie, really bugs me, besides that it's England, the way people drive.
Yes.
Is we have to have that bathroom done.
Yes.
We cannot.
What I don't understand is if you love Acton School so much, why'd you turn us into the DSA?
Loser.
Oh,
really? Did you just say that?
Oh, you guys, this isn't constructive.
Okay. Did you see my whole answer?
I have two questions.
Listen. Yeah. Listen.
Ken, I have two questions here.
Hang on. I'm almost
on the same thing.
I'm almost done.
Okay.
How can we attract people to come to our school to play when they're changing out in the back of a station wagon? I just can't have that anymore. Okay? So if I were to rat hole everything, I'd want to get the school open. I really would. But that bathroom and that change area at Vasquez is a priority to me. I'm done now.
Okay. Now, just for the people who might be listening,
looking at Project Acton Street School, looking at the phase 1 and 2 soft costs of $402,000, is that something that's necessary for phase 1 to be completed that we're looking at only $697,000?
It would be, what I did is I just combined it rather than breaking it apart. You would take, to calculate soft costs on, actually I can tell you, let me think for a minute. Okay, phase one would be 871,000, so it would be the 697, and then 25% estimate for soft costs for engineering. And that
about 100,000?
About 160.
160?
Well, 150 would be 25% of 600,000.
Yeah,
so just rounding it off, for us to proceed with the minimum on Acton School, we would be talking pretty close to like $1 million of the 1.7.
That would be a healthy commitment. I would say 900 to a million.
And that could at least
phase one.
Keep us moving phase one for Acton School and still leave us $723,000 to argue about in the future. Now, the other second question is, of the matching funds and our great big fund of $25 and some odd cents of our bond money, can we use any of that money in Vasquez project phase on the top on phase three? Can
you
carry over into that?
Fund 14, Fund 25, and Fund 40 can all be used in any district.
Fund what now? Fund
14, so what says maintenance.
Okay, I wasn't referring to that.
Fund 25, capital facility.
No, I wasn't referring
and
to
capital
that.
And capital outlay, Fund 40.
Okay, so your answer is we cannot use, it doesn't really matter, Fund 21, that's minimal.
Well,
but
for Acton, maybe I didn't understand Vasquez.
No, not for Acton,
for
Vasquez, where we have projected projects,
uh-huh.
The softballs under the first box,
uh-huh.
Plus other stuff, restroom, that
uh-huh.
helps Ken. And then the other one, in other words, can we carry over any of that money to the Vasquez?
Yes. Any of those five can be used on Vasquez.
Okay, so that means we have a little more than 723 left to spend if we're estimating about $1 million for Acton School, and then we're getting some of the stuff we want in the first box for Vasquez out of Fund 35. That gives us what, to $2 million left? $2,300,000, which,
yeah.
I don't know how much is not in the red column as encumbered, but still needs to be very shortly. That may be a big figure. But you see the point where I'm going is how we can spend what limited money we have the best way we can for the schools.
Mm-hmm. Right, and I would need to play around with a little more, but I didn't want to put any scenarios because I know that, you know, Mr. King will tell you that I kind of struggled with how do I organize this in a way that they can play with it and use it without them thinking, oh my goodness, look at what she's telling us to do. But just to play with this, well, what would happen if we finished out the Vasquez not doing any bid alternates, so the 2.7, and did phase one of ACT and hard and soft costs, we could do those things if they come in the price it's supposed to. We could do phase one of ACT and hard and soft, and we could do that first part, A, B, C, and E, you know, not the bid alternates, but the bids on Vasquez. And we would still have about $400,000, you know, if everything plays out the way it's supposed to, $400,000 in case something,
wait,
the roof caves in.
Now that's the first time you've lost me. So may I?
Sure.
Okay, we're so close. Larry, I think you hit on something important. Fund 35 can only be used on Vasquez. We agree.
Right.
The other funds can be used. Forget the $25. It's not worth even having it on the chart anymore other than completeness. The other funds can be used either on at Vasquez or Acton. Okay.
Or the other projects.
There's, or
middle box.
Middle box is Vasquez.
No.
Yes.
Middle box is
no,
tennis courts,
that's
basketball courts.
That is Vasquez.
Oh.
That's the bid alternates.
Well,
okay.
So we have to get kind of in one place. Somewhat arbitrarily, we broke phase three into two buckets. And I'm not going to use the terms A and B because we already have A, B, C, D, E, F, G on the charts.
Okay.
But we took phase three of Vasquez and we somewhat arbitrarily put it in two buckets. And that's what the top box for 2.7 million and the middle box is.
Okay.
So you sum them and that says the wish list for phase three is $3.9 million. Just call it four. We have 2.3 million of dedicated Vasquez money.
Exactly.
Okay. Now, Acton School is $2 million, we think. What's available for it? Well, the 2.3 million is not available in the account side because that's dedicated to Vasquez.
Correct.
So
it's
1.7 million.
So it's 1.7, that's right. And so that's where you kind of lost me. How do you get, without finding 300,000 more, how do you get Acton done at its preliminary projected cost of $2 million?
Well, if
you don't
mind,
take it from the 2.3 million of Vasquez.
So, no.
Because that's earmarked for Vasquez by law.
Can we reduce lawyer support and fiscal consulting support for charter schools, and then we would have.
Well,
I don't know the answer to that yet because I don't know.
Let us know.
Give us an answer. What were you going
to
say?
Well, there was, just to show you, there was like when I was scratching around. So basically, I think we're all looking at it in a slightly different way. So what I did is I took Vasquez and said, here's the cost that it would be, 2.7 million. And then,
for the first half of it.
And
yes.
Then, for everything that's a bit. And then I said, okay, well, if I use up all of Fund 35, wipe that out, then that would leave 400,000 that I need.
That's correct.
And then I wipe out Fund 25, 169,000, yes. That leaves 250,000. And then I take yes. that from Fund 14.
Yes.
Then I said, okay, at Act, and I need 871,000. I can take out five.
Yes.
I can, you know, take out, clear out Fund 40.
871,000.
Is the total for Acton Part 1, hard and soft. So what you'd have to do is take
the base and then multiply.
And I said, okay, what would happen if that? Then I need $5,000 more, and that could get Vasquez bid, you know, the main bid, and then we could do phase one, and then that would leave around $400,000. So I basically started using up funds.
Yes, I think what you're basically
we're all looking at it the same thing in a different way.
What do you understand principles, Pat?
I'm almost there. What you described was with the $4 million upstairs and keeping aside what color the monies are, you could do the first box and phase one of Acton School.
I believe so.
Right.
You know, I had the same problem when my mom and dad gave me a $2 a week for my allowance when I was 8 years old. And I had to go and figure out all the different places with it, and it added up to $4.83. And I had to do just what she was doing.
Yes, so I think that what you just kind of described is what's rational. The only spin I put on it, and this is where perhaps Ken's suggestion that you guys bring your recommendation for, is I agree with you, the bathrooms, got to have the bathrooms. But the other part of the partitioning into bucket A and bucket B at Vasquez, there's nothing gospel about that. You can repartition to ensure for the most value.
Okay? What I would be interested in there, only as a matter of information, that stuff is put together because it's related to grading and duplicity of project. Is there an offset? And if you got the money, you got the money. If you don't, you don't. What purchasing power do we use by making those things their own projects?
Okay, so that's a good question because in the little bit of time I've had, it's an important question to ask ourselves. Again, if the money's there, it's there, and it's not, it's not. But the reason that you'll take a construction project out to bid and put bid alternates in there is you're saying this is the minimum we can live with. We have to have the softball field, and we have to pay for the architect.
So, okay, you just said it. I'm going to go there.
And so the next thing, those others, what they'll do is they'll say, well, I'm already driving my tractor, so we think it would cost $600,000, but my tractor's already there, so I don't have to pay my guy to get the tractor there.
So we are hoping it's going to come in less.
Yes. So the danger in not also doing the bid alternates is that it could cost more than that amount of 1.2 for two reasons. One, as time goes on, the cost of labor and materials goes up, and that's a given, but also because the, I can't remember what it's called, but the magnitude of everything's already there.
No, what you're trying to say, I'm on board, maybe you got it as well.
As long as Arona has searched this and that, there's not some time bomb beam in the ceiling that's going to cost us the extra $100,000 of work orders. That's the only thing.
But what you're just describing here is there's some economies of scale.
That's the word.
So if we have to break it into two pieces, top bucket and bottom bucket, the middle bucket could actually get more expensive in an out year, not just because of inflation, but because you lose economies of scale, which is why it's important to the extent that we can communicate with these guys, which is say, you know, give us a dang good price, because it's not going to get better if we have to split it up. It's going to only get worse. Because you lose the economies of scale, the fact that they're already on your site. But if and that's why it's important that we don't have too much conservatism in the other numbers, because if you believe this, says we can't leverage the economies of scale unless we're going to leave this school closed. That's what the table says. And that's not really an option because we're already
we need the space, and we're already committed to this school to a certain extent. I mean, phase one of this school has to happen. Unless we're just going to stop and keep kids in the library. So
the stages.
So, I mean, what I draw from this chart, and that's why, you know, Mark is not here, I'll say it for him. You know, it's important to be conservative on the other parts of the budget because you don't want to end up with Laco here again watching you. But it's bad to be overly conservative because it makes you not do things. And in some cases, not doing things now can cost more later. So the only thing I'll add to that, but it's clear we have to finish this school unless any of us are going to walk away from it. And finish it to the point where students are in. And that's why I was very clear about, can you get students in for six?
And I do need to follow up and push them on that. Like, what does that actually mean? I only have plans for phase two right now. What I know is on phase two, just on the one page that I looked
phase
at.
Phase two acting.
I was, trying to get this done and stuff like that. But I do know that, like, for example, on phase two, the pathways.
Phase two acting.
Includes some pathways and some changes to things like that. So
now. And here's, I think, Ken and I agree, and you know, at some point we're going to have to decide these, but we're venting, airing ideas because you're collecting them. Mm-hmm. The bathroom up there has got to happen. So that part of phase 3A, for lack of a better term, isn't negotiable. Plus, by the way, they're building it right now because we let that contract out.
You're talking about a bathroom in where?
Okay. But unless it doesn't make sense from the order in which you do things, because that was a somewhat arbitrary splitting of goals, it is reasonable to say, and I'm just going to put it out there, with a softball field at the park, does it make sense to duplicate a softball field at the school? So good, then the park one will never get used at all. And in the meantime, not bring in something that there's none for 15 miles in each direction, like the tennis courts, which the whole community could use, or at least the whole community's kids. Maybe the whole community could agree with the parks people. So these are the kinds of things we really got to look at when we say you guys should prioritize it. You know, if you really got to end up prioritizing these, do we need two softball fields in town, and one's hardly used.
Yeah, I guess we have to balance that.
But you can't be ripping up one thing for the other thing.
We have to balance that with what's the actual likelihood of making up that shortage, and if we decide that that's not a big possibility and it's not going to happen,
do the smart thing.
Then we need to start order of priority, and I think that's got to be a whole meeting in and of itself, and we got to just really go through that and then decide and stick to it. And this is how, for instance, with the high school, we started Plan E. You of course weren't here for that, but we weren't getting our matching fund from the state, so we went through a series of plans A through H, and we picked Plan E, which was just for $13 million. Luckily, we got our matching bond in that process, and we went for the full-fledged, campus. But we have to have a meeting and identify the shortage, make sure that we are positive that we cannot get that money somehow, and then at that point go in some kind of itemization and do a cost and benefit analysis. And I agree with you.
And that's that's an obvious. Was actually suggesting.
This almost goes back to the joint use agreement that I'm not saying that I have in favor of. I won't argue against it right now. That's not the purpose here. But that softball field shouldn't be decided to be denied here because of there being a softball field that is part of the county facility. That the girls, the high school girls, have been waiting years and years for their own high school softball field. The boys have football, baseball, and all that. And I think we have to give it a lot of thought when we're figuring out what the minimal cost is of the softball field, of all those items.
Agreed.
And
community meetings like we had in high school.
There's no disagreement.
With a paralysis of analysis, neither field, any field that we have right now, is CIF approved for tournament play. Is that right?
We have some fields that are not.
Baseball field.
Baseball's one of them.
Softball field.
That's not even on the list. It doesn't even exist.
Okay, so, at the end of this project, the way it sits, if our team is going to win the state tournament next year, both of them, and I know that the tie's gonna make that happen, we would be embarrassed by not even being able to play, much less use the restroom. Yeah.
No, he's talking about the restroom.
Excuse me. Yes, sir?
Just real quick, to be fair, the boys and girls of the teams that have made playoffs have greatly enjoyed being able to play at local college facilities for those CIF games. So it's not...
So that's an indicator.
It would be nice if we drew a home game for a playoff game to have it at home.
Yeah.
That would be nice, and we have that in basketball, obviously, in volleyball. We don't have that for field sports.
But you didn't have that in volleyball, but you had a bathroom and a bunch of trailer houses. So there's trade-offs in life. Right.
Just saying, I wouldn't say that's pressing. I'd say we've been very creative, and everyone's been pretty happy with the alternatives we've come up with.
There's lots of sports, unfortunately, that we can't have CIF playoffs here, cross country.
But that has always hung up in the back of my head when we're building fields. Is there a way to at least give the girls a field that they could have a tournament play on?
I would think so. All new facilities that we've been considering, by the way, all of them, with the exception of the track that's part of the middle bucket, I think. One of them has a track around it, the softball field. All of them are CIF. All of our work at Vasquez has been, you can use it for CIF. So we didn't put in a gym that you couldn't use for CIF activities. The only thing that we were talking about not having CIF approved was our little pseudo track that was going to go around.
Practice track.
Some of these, yeah, the practice track.
It's important to note the difference between regulation for games, which all of our fields and play areas are.
A regulation
and
for games.
And CIF qualified, okay. Which is what Ken was alluding to. A baseball fence has to be 375 to center or deeper, and we're not because of the road. Things like that.
So the wraps with stuff, you think you need to go through the cafeteria items?
Yeah, let me bring us back a little bit just to make sure I'm understanding direction. So we will have some staffing meetings, we will have some contingent facilities meetings, we'll have some site meetings at Vasquez High School to get, I think we need to get input from your staff as well, particularly your athletic staff. I've spoke to a couple of them, I know they have thoughts about baseball field, the softball field, the tennis, and even the basketball court. So they talk about very specific things, like it takes me 12 minutes to walk up to these basketball courts. I don't know if I'm ever going to use them. I mean, they have very specific thoughts. So I think it's important to get back with staff and drill down, because that's just system leadership. We don't want to make decisions at the top that are affecting people that are the rank and file doing these things on a day-to-day basis without their input. So I think that's important. And then we'll drill down, we'll come back up to our facilities meetings and our cabinet meetings and come to you with some recommendations on prioritization.
And the only thing that I would add to that statement, everything I agree with it, it should consider what like facilities there are in town.
Sure.
I mean, it would be silly not to.
I agree. And so we'll be sure to note that in our discussion. I would suggest to the board that we come back with another similar meeting to this after December 14th, that we do a special board meeting just focused on this piece, because this is very time consuming and pretty intensive.
How about December 24th?
Perfect.
Late evening.
But bring those recommendations, those alternatives, that to both these gentlemen forward after you talk to staff.
I'm excited to see this team click and come forward and tell us what to do and not the other way around.
Yeah. So
when I'm in charge of the education of the students in this district, there is a huge problem.
I'm gonna let the board know a couple things ahead of time.
I second that.
At that meeting, a couple things that I wanna give you a heads up on. I would like to bring Mike Arona into that meeting. I think it's very important for these facilities discussions. He can speak to the very specific pieces of phase one and two, to your DSA questions. What is there any piece of phase two that we must get done in order to accommodate ADA? So I want to have Mike Aroni here for that piece. The other thing I would like to
get... Any updates about Jim Bowes' involvement?
I basically, he's not involved in the Acton piece at all. Mike Arona attends both facilities meetings, both the Acton School Project as well as Phase 3 Vasquez. Jim Vos only attends the Phase 3 of Vasquez. Yeah. The other piece that I just want to get clarification from the board on to make sure you're okay with it, and are you all familiar with an emergency resolution with regard to the bidding process? So if I would like to bring this before the board. And so this is a resolution that legal counsel would draft for the board. And what it would allow us to do specifically with the Acton School Project is to not go through that bidding process for, there's many, many items on the Acton School Project that are over $15,000. We'd have to go out and bid on each one of those. It would allow us the flexibility, and you're allowed to approve a resolution when you have mitigating circumstances. For example, you have traffic backing up at Metal Arc School. You have impacted classrooms at Metal Arc School and students using the stage. So you have time-sensitive pieces that would give the board solid justification to approve this type of resolution. And it would allow us as staff the flexibility to move more expediently through the process and more efficiently on Acton School. The caveat is it requires a unanimous vote. It then goes to the county for their stamp of approval. So
you would have my support on it. I know that cutting through that formal bureaucracy, I trust that you wouldn't do dumb things like, you know, not look at a bid for reasonableness or things like that. You'd have my support.
Sure.
You're kind of fishing for levels of support.
Yeah, exactly.
You need it to be unanimous. So
what I need to know is how would this affect, say, my uncle getting the job?
There would be no nepotism involved at all in the process.
Okay, so how would it affect how the bids are opened in front of contractors? Excuse me, I do this all day long.
It allows you to go through that process without having to go through the formal bidding process, but there are folks that Mr. Rona knows that would look at this project, be willing to work on this project, and have reputable work. Both he and I worked with them in Baldwin Park as well as Covina.
What I don't want is I don't want somebody coming in here and saying, in 1927, you didn't take my bid, so now I'm going to call the IRS on you.
Well, I think on a more serious note also, what you're concerned about is that, you know, in all fairness, the public has a chance to bid on everything as opposed to if you just run things through and Mr. Roman likes a certain person, he just like goes with them. Because as a public entity, there should be open bidding for all these things, right? So I think in cases, I'm with Mike and with Ken, and I'm both kind of in the middle, where if it has to do with, if it has to do for convenience and it's something that's not that substantial, yes, but it cannot become our way of doing things where we multiply 15,000 by 20 and we got $300,000 of work, where basically was not subject to the open bidding process. If that makes sense.
We have estimates on all of these pieces. This process is the exception to the rule, to your point, Mr. Porter. So this isn't the rule. This resolution exists to allow districts that find themselves in a predicament like ours so that we can finish the project to the board's satisfaction in a timely manner. There's so many pieces to it that exceed that non-bid limit that I will have a more difficult, challenging time completing the project in the board's requested timeline without this resolution.
I think a comparable is the lease buyback, where you're limiting costs. I also have gone through a number of projects. I got one, if you watch the city website, you'll see something come up about a tree planting project. It's got an RFP and all kinds of environmental stuff. It gets to a point where you release a bid and it's like somebody comes in so low that you look at it and then you try to disqualify them because it's obvious they missed something, and then the people up here are going, what are you doing? So I understand where you're going with this, and I understand the process. The way around that is to pre-qualify bidders before the project is bid, is really the way around that, and it's a way that the public can look at it and say, okay, I understand what your criteria was for pre-qualifying these bidders. And if that pre-qualification process consists of, have you put a bathroom in at the high school before? How many times have you done that? How many times do you have references? Do you, have you gone over, how many change orders were there? There's a criteria for being able to do that. But again, I don't want somebody coming in here and saying I was excluded in all this conspiracy theory that goes with it. We need to get this done quickly, but it needs to be in a transparent way. My suggestion is that you look at, I don't know if that exists in school systems, but pre-qualifying bidders for certain types of work.
I had a question. Why is Amanda sitting up here?
We were just afraid of pushing Ms. McCulley off the steps.
That's where
okay, I'll lose some weight. It's okay.
That's where Kim Lytle said.
We do want to do that, but we just want to make sure that we're all good up here.
Just need a chair. Victor. I expect
Thank
to see
you.
You next time.
I'm good.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, well, we're all good. I mean, I think
he's trying to get the temperature of the board. He's heard from three
yeah.
of us.
Larry?
Your temperature, Larry? It has to be unanimous.
As long as it is needed and proper.
I've got my vote on it.
Okay.
We're all good.
Okay.
In other words, you told us the purpose of the resolution. The purpose is there. I see no reason why not.
And you understood my objection to it, if it's kind of clumped together a bunch
yes.
of it. And as long as that we're good with that, then.
Okay. Thank you.
Did you have anything else
by tonight? No, the only closing thought I had is I wrote down one little small note I'll share with you because it was early in Ms. David's presentation. I think it was, it's on page 3 of the handout, which would be slide number 5. Unduplicated pupil percentage, 20% times the base. The only thing I wrote here was, never seen it in such plain English. I've seen many, many board presentations by CBOs, and I've never seen so much laid out in just plain English and palatable to the common person.
You're stealing my thunder.
I love that word, palatable.
So thank you so much.
This is a little bit awkward.
Yeah, we're saying this together.
Having said that, this was probably
the best
we've seen, and it allowed us to have the most.
You really dumbed it down for us. Thank you.
That's another, not a wee thing. That's
a thing. You did a really nice job at something that you've only been in for a couple of months, and you would never even have known you've only been in a couple of months.
Yeah. We're very fortunate to have a person of your caliber.
This was fantastic.
Thank you. I appreciate the compliment, but I just want you to know that I was not sure because I don't want you to think that I'm being condescending or making any assumption about what people do or don't know. So
volunteers.
No, it's
I think it's important for you to be able to make informed decisions to be able to understand what
you did a great job.
And I know you're available for us
it's
to be available.
Clearly written.
Where did they come up with the term unduplicated? Do you have any idea?
I know exactly where it came from.
Okay.
Because
of course you do.
I do. I know exactly because it's an unduplicated count. And so what that means is I can be an English learner and low income, and I only get counted once in the count in this formula. I don't get counted twice. In the old days of categoricals, you had a pot of money, and you could be an English learner, and you get a few dollars here. You could be
so what
low
was
income.
The three categories?
English learner.
Mm-hmm. Foster.
Foster, and low income.
I was all three of those.
You would have counted three times.
And look where I am now.
But unduplicated
yeah, but unduplicated
all
ones
three.
In the count.
Okay.
So you can be one of those things, or you can be all three, but I counted you one time.
I don't think I counted at all.
But it's still duplicated.
Okay, where are we going from here?
Because the money for the original 8,000 is still there, and then you have the add-ons.
I don't think we'll have that special board meeting prior to winter break.
Yeah.
So, Mr. President, on December 14th, under future calendar dates, I think on December 14th, we can set one for sometime in January, is my thought.
And,
sure.
And Mr. President, if it's okay with you, I'd like to ask Yolanda to put on future agenda items the studying about developer fees.
It needs to go on the list, so I don't forget.
Yeah. We're not going to have a board meeting on the 14th?
We are, but we need to have a special board meeting for you to get our feedback and input on prioritization of all the things we talked about tonight. So we'll do a special board meeting at the end of January, and on December 14th, we'll set that under future agenda.
Oh, that's what's key about the 14th, is when we pick the date for the go-back. Yeah.
Okay. On January 14th, or December 14th. We pick it for January.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Anything else?
I would really like to thank Tim for being here tonight and for memorializing this. It's unfortunate that the usual press, besides you, we always appreciate you because you videotape this, and sometimes that's good for me, but most times not. I wish Lillian could have been here to capture this in depth.
All right. 9:15.
Okay, it's 9:50. So you're not camera shy, are you?
No.
If you look like this, Mike, imagine that. Would you be?
It's 9:15. I'm closing the hearing. The special board meeting of the Board of Trustees adjourned at
9:16
p.m.
So moved, Mr. President.